This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otter-g-g-g-g. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of the Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Well, thank you very much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of that most fantabulous old-time radio program you're ever going to want to hear anywhere, anyplace, anytime, The Glowing Dial. I am your host, Big John Matthews, sitting across the desk from me, as always, my ever-present, ever-silly, ever... sleeping, it looks like, co-host,
nope.
Mr. Steve...
Meditating.
Our meditating co-host, Steve Archive Urbanic.
Now look what you made me do. You made me talk before I was introduced.
Steve...
That's bad.
Steve
radio
Zen Archive Urbanic.
I will have some messages from beyond for you.
Did you say you have some messages from beyond for me?
This is Steve the Guru talking here to you.
Would there be a squishy involved in any of this?
It could be very good for you.
A Zen Squishy, new from 7-Eleven, the Quickie Mart.
You did not know I could talk Hindu, did you? I can.
I still don't. But anyway, folks, Steve and I are turning the Glowing Dial page into a web page today with our tribute to... turning the Glowing Dial page into a web page... Thank you. Thank you so much, Ringo. I hate when I have to prompt you like that, but, you know. Yes, it's a
he
tribute.
He was sleeping.
It's a tribute to Jack Webb this time on The Glowing Dial. And we have five different series that Jack Webb was in to bring you. One of them, the first one, is going to be a bit of a departure for Mr. Webb. But we're going to tell you about all of that when we come back right after this. Perhaps the funniest series ever on radio is now available in a 14-CD limited edition package. That's all 273 episodes, plus bonus material. Yes, available at last. The complete story of Chicken Man. This is the ultimate collector's package, mastered from the original master tapes by Dick Orkin, Chicken Man's creator and voice. Aside from every Chicken Man episode ever made, this package includes interviews with key players, behind-the-scenes stories, and an official color photo, personally autographed by Chicken Man himself. And each limited edition package is individually numbered. A very naughty criminal mastermind, now a reformed swell guy, says of our hero...
The most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known.
An anonymous admirer says...
He's poultry in motion.
By now, you're probably asking yourself, how the heck can I get one of these neato packages? Well, simply hop online and go to glowingdial.com. Scroll down and you'll see the magnificent, no-expense-spared advertisement and ordering link. Remember, this is a limited edition numbered package, so you better hurry up and order. If you don't, you might miss out. And then all I can say is, well... And we are back. I'm Big John. That's Steve. And it's time to... Hi, Steve. How are you?
Hi.
We didn't do something that we usually do for you here.
And, see, we introduced Ringo. We introduced me. What else is there?
All those people back there that have just finished their hot dogs are waiting to
give
you your
due. Couldn't do anything before anyway because they were eating their hot dog. They had their mouths full.
Well, they could have shoved it in their mouths and applauded. You know,
that would have been rude, too. But go ahead. Give them their...
But I guess they couldn't whistle with a hot dog in their mouth. It goes shooting out of their mouth and hits the guy in front of them.
It's the Three Stooges skit, I know.
Yeah. Sorry, let's give Steve his round of applause there, folks. There they go. They love you. They love you.
And without hot dogs in that, that's much better. Great.
Thank you. Okay, folks, cool it. Cool it. All right. See, they like to get a little rowdy at times there, and Ringo's there to... give them, he holds his drumsticks up and gives that stern look on his face, and they, you know, they quiet down. And,
yes.
Okay, Ringo.
All they have to do is see that little imprint on his drumstick that says Tyson on it, and they know he means business. Tyson drumsticks.
Thank you. That was a pity rim shot there, Ringo. And see, he used up one of his rim shots on his lease just for that corny joke.
I feel pity. Oh, so pity.
And pity and... Okay. No, sorry. Anyway, folks, it's our tribute to Jack Webb here on this edition of The Glowing Dial. And the first installment we have is Jack's comedy show, The Jack Webb Show.
What? Comedy, you say?
Jack
Webb with comedy?
Comedy,
oh, can't. It cannot be true.
It cannot be true.
Oh, really?
All right, you're really, you're exaggerating that, Steve. You're just overacting a bit there. Yeah.
Oh, me. Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, but no, this is one of the earliest offerings from Jack Webb. His comedy show was heard on the West Coast. This episode is called Slim Slade, Western Band Leader. It's all about the residents of Howdyville. Howdy.
Howdy-doody.
Yeah, howdy-howdy. You'll hear it. This is from April 17th, 1946, and it went out on ABC West Coast over KGO, where Jack did some of his shows from. Starring Jack Webb, John Galbraith, Clancy Hayes, Nora McNamara, Phil Bavero and the Ragged Heirs, and the show was sustained. And, you know, Phil Bavero and the Ragged Heirs were a Dixieland band. Mm-hmm. And Jack Webb had a love of Dixieland music, which fit in here. But it's wonderful to hear Jack doing comedy because he's always so straight-faced as all these detectives that we'll be featuring later on. And on Dragnet, Joe Friday, I mean, how much more straight-laced and emotionless can you get? I mean, he smiled a few times there, but... Steve, why don't you tell us a little bit about the Jack Webb Show?
Here's the facts, ma'am. Just the facts. Okay, the Jack Webb Show, strangely enough, is described as a madcap comedy variety show.
It kind of was. There were musical numbers, too.
Broadcast history. The spring of 1946, it was on ABC West Coast out of KGO in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
30 minutes long on Wednesdays at 9:30 Pacific time. The insane bit of fluff was one of Jack Webb's earliest efforts, so out of character for the man who created Dragnet and airing 3 years before that landmark police show. The routines were packed with absurd one-liners and nonstop silliness. Sounds good.
Yeah, sounds like us.
Sounds like us. Webb's love of traditional jazz is reflected in a roaring Dixieland backup by Phil Bavero and eight retards known as the Ragged Heirs. That's right from the book, folks.
Yeah, and that's what they called them, too.
As for the rest of the cast, Webb's ripping closing signature says it best. Tonight's egg was laid on the vocal side by Clancy Hayes and Nora McNamara. John Galbraith blew the lines and Dick Breen glued the joints together. Translation, Breen wrote the script as he would for Jack's 1947 detective show, Pat Novak.
Right.
That's the translation for that. So.
And that's the whole write-up.
That
there.
Is the entire write-up on the Jack Webb Show.
And there are only two episodes of this known to be in existence right now. And we have both of them in our clutchy hands, our archives. So we're going to be tuning one of these in for you.
I'll have to arrest you if you don't have the rights to that show.
So sue me.
I can't. I'm dead.
Oh. Well, we're very sorry about that.
Okay.
Nothing we could do about it, unfortunately, though.
No, yeah.
So, Stephen, why don't you reach for the McGee machine?
Oh, yes.
And let us tune this episode in.
Yeah, we can't get it without
me
doing that.
Oh, yes. And he's been pre-warmed for your convenience, for your tuning convenience. And he's winking at you again. This machine just has a thing for Steve, apparently. I don't know.
I'll eat my Twinkie as it winkies.
Right, and as Steve does that, sit back, folks. Close your eyes and remember the Jack Webb Show. Slim Slade, Western bandleader, from April 17th, 1946, originally over ABC West Coast and KGO.
The following is transcribed.
No, it isn't.
The following is transcribed.
No, it isn't.
Oh, yes, it is.
It is not.
Yes, it is.
It is not.
It is, too.
It is not.
It is.
It isn't.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
The following is not transcribed.
This week, the Major League Baseball season opened. In keeping with this, the American Broadcasting Company brings you the first foul ball of the season. It's the Jack Webb Show in its fifth consecutive strikeout. Nothing new has been added. The Ragged Airs will play tonight, but without their director, Phil Bavero, who only confused the men anyway. That spiritual singer, Clancy Hayes, of the firm of Haig & Haig & Hayes, will conduct his usual contest with the orchestra. She's young, she's pretty, she sings. That's three runs for our side, vocalist Nora McNamara. John Galbraith, an Oakland boy, and the only argument we can think of against the Bay Bridge, will play rats and second lieutenants and spooky people, and, oh yes, a wonderful gal with a wonderful voice has made a terrible mistake tonight. Midge Williams has agreed to set her career back 10 years with a guest appearance on the Jack Webb Show. My name is Jordan, and I'm going to find a nice, quiet room until this thing blows over. Why don't you do the same?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How are all our listeners out there? Both of you. John Galbraith, put your glasses on so you can find the microphone and come on over here, will you?
Oh, Jack, my boy, that's certainly a healthy crop of freckles you picked up in the San Francisco sunshine.
What do you mean, freckles? Those are the holes in the microphone. Put them on, will you?
Yeah. Hey, but of course, how stupid of me, Jack. Your head doesn't say ABC on it, does it?
Neither do yours, John. Don't we have a grand studio audience here tonight, John? You know who these boys are.
Who are the girls?
Finally got the... Oh, you finally got those glasses on, huh, John? Well, these men are 200 Army patients from Letterman General Hospital here in San Francisco. And most of them have only been in this country 4 days. Some of them one day.
Jack, who are the girls?
I think we ought to have some ruffles and flourishes for the generals here tonight.
Who are the girls?
Welcome home, generals.
Who are the girls?
The girls, John.
Oh, say. Yeah.
There's 75 hostesses from the Oak Street USO.
Aren't they, though?
Yeah, well, I guess we ought to have some ruffles and flourishes for them, too, you know? Yeah. They've already got the ruffles. Let's just have the flourishes, shall we? That is the first time that those guys have ever gotten together since we went on the air. I don't
Presenting...
A page torn from the private files of Slim Slade, Western bandleader.
We return to the little western town of Howdyville, where a group of citizens are talking. Howdyville, nobody quite knows how it got its name.
Howdy.
Slim Slade, just a poor old cowpoke out on the plains of Howdyville.
Hey, Slim, what you doing out there?
Oh, just poking around the cows.
Well, come on over here. Got a letter for you with a city writing on it.
Letter with city writing, hmm? Didn't know nobody I knowed could write. Don't make no difference, though. I can't read.
Well, you don't... You don't have to, Slim. I done read it.
Oh, what do it say?
Oh, don't say nothing, Slim. It's just a letter.
Well, I don't mean talk, say. I mean read, say.
Well, why don't you talk, say what you mean, say?
Yeah.
It's from your brother.
Oh, that's Slick.
That's right. Signed Slick Slade.
Wait a minute. Wait just a minute. I'm going to get the boys. Hey, Weasel, Fox, and Snake. Sounds like a zoo, don't it? Come on over here, boys. Hey, anybody seen Enchilada Gomez?
See, Slade, I'm over here taking a little fiesta.
That's siesta.
See.
Come on over here, boys.
Well, howdy, Slim.
Howdy. See, I got a letter from a brother in Hawaii.
Slim, I believe that's pronounced Hawaii.
Oh, yeah. I never was much good in them European names.
Go ahead, Weasel. Here's the letter.
Yeah, Weasel, what do it say?
Why, don't say nothing, Slim. It's just a letter.
Well, I don't mean talk, say. I mean read, say.
Why don't you talk, say, what you mean, say? It's from your brother.
Daggone, I know that.
Well, the letter says...
I thought you...
Quiet, Slim. Dear friend brother, I'm making lots of money. I never knowed when I left Fort Worth there was so doggone much money in the world. I'm making... lots of money.
Doggone, brother.
Doggone, brother. Money is one thing I got plenty of. Like Ma said, money can't buy friends. But who wants friends when you got this much money?
Doggone, brother. Sure must have struck it rich.
Doggone, brother. I sure struck it rich. I'm making plenty of money. I got myself a Western band, and we play Western music.
That's a novelty.
And we're all making lots of money over here in Hawaii. We call the Western band Slick Slade and his Hilo Gila Monster. That is all for now on account of... I have run out of gold paper, which I write on, and besides, my 24-carat diamond pinpoint done busted. Your friend, your brother, Slick. P.S. I sure am making lots of money.
Brother Slick is right. We're going to do the same thing. We're all going to organize a Western band.
Good idea, Slim.
See, Slade, I think we better do it banana.
That's manana.
See.
Come on, saddle up, boys. We're going to ride to New York. I'm going to write the tunes on the way. All right, boys, come on, move in. We're going to rehearse a spell. Now, here's a tune I writ. Music and notes by me. It's called... Oh, this will kill you. When it's apple blossom time in Fort Worth.
Oh, that's awful pretty, Slim.
Yeah, ain't it?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's play it through once. You ready on the drums, Enchilada? I want plenty of drums in this. All right, you ready, boys? Here we go. Play it just like she was wrote. Everybody set?
Hey, Slim, what's all these little black spots all over this paper?
I was wondering about that, too, Slim. Seems to me you could have got clean paper. Well, you know, as long as you was a-paying for it.
Them's notes. Them's what you play.
Oh, excuse me.
Yeah, now, come on. Here we go. I'm going to count three. Are you ready? Put her in half. I'll stop my foot three times. Get set now. It's going to come fast. You got to be ready. Let's play her just like she was wrote. Don't leave nothing out. It's all good. If you get lost, keep it going. Don't go straggling all over this song like a doge. Come on. Relax. Tighten up. Smile. Frown, because you're going to enjoy this one. Steady in the saddle. I'm counting. One, two. Hold it. Hold it, boys. I better tell you. We're going to start this number on three. You got that, boys? Or you want to write it down? Here we go. One, two. Hold it. Hold it. I guess I better announce our name just like we're going to do it uptown. Present. Slim Slade and his makes you want to dance when they're playing a hoedown and just sit down and cry when they're playing a sad one. Western Band. You think that name's too long? Well, all right, here we go. Real down-to-earth music right out of the dirt. Put her in half. Well, let's go. One, two, hit it. No, oh, I forgot I was supposed to say the number three. Hold it, boys, hold it. Hold it. You've done right good on that one. You've done right good on... Well, it's Apple Blossom Time in Fort Worth. Now, I got another one I want to try. Music and notes by me. It's called Horsefly Pie and Apple Pan Howdy. All right, boys. One, two, kick it. Doggone, I always forget to say three. Hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it. That's mighty pretty, ain't it? Which one of those you like the best? Well, never mind. I got another one here I want to try. Music and notes by me. This is a sad one, boys. It's a prison song. It's called I Might As Well Be Sprung. Okay, let's do her. One, two, take her. Now, why didn't I say three? Hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it. Boys, boys, I gotta say, you sure are versatile. Them three are the prettiest tunes I ever did hear. Now, I think we're all ready to go. But before we do, I got one more tune I'd like to try. Music and notes by me. I call this one Bang, Bang, Bang Went My Six Gun. That's pretty, ain't it? Kind of nostalgic. All right, boys, one, two, play it. Now, what happened to three?
Slim Slade and his Western Band. First, it's the Pennsylvania Roof. Then the Wedgwood Room of the Waldorf. Carnegie Hall, millions of phonograph records, radio coast to coast. Yes, Slim Slade and his band had arrived on the musical scene. And then, one day, disaster.
Boys, I got sad news. They tied the can to us. We're through. We've been fired plumb out of New York.
Oh, what's the trouble, Slim?
Well, the manager of that there radio station told me tonight that we wasn't versatile enough. Said all our tunes sounded alike. I don't know how he figured that. We got 47 tunes. All of them got different names. Music and notes by me. Come on, boys, pick up your instruments. Let's play a couple of them numbers and see what that fella's talking about. All right, the go down, hold down. That's good, that's good. Hey, wait a minute. Hold it just a minute. Them drums ain't quite loud enough, enchilada. A little of that melody sneaked through in one play. Okay, more drums this time, and let's hear the Gila Monster Waltz. Okay. Now I want to hear one more. I want to hear Oh, You Beautiful Texas. This is pretty. I love it. All right, now listen. Now let's go back. Let's do a little reviewing. Let's go way back. Let's hear our first hit. The tune that brung us here. When it's apple blossom time in Fort Worth. Okay, boys. Oh, that no. That fella don't know what he's talking about. Them's four of the prettiest tunes I ever heard. But we're going back to Texas. I'm plumb played out. I ain't got another tune in me. I'm just like that fella Irvine Berlin. Only he's got someone to help him with them lyrics. I got to write the notes myself. Saddle up, boys. We're all through. We're going back to poking cows. If we stay here any longer, we're going to get in a rut.
Sure is good being back in Texas, ain't it?
Yeah, I don't miss that Pennsylvania roof, none. Fella by the name of Benny Goodman done moved in after us.
Who's he?
Oh, here comes Slim now. Well, howdy, Slim Slade.
Howdy. Saddle up, boys. We're going back to New York. I've done it again. We got it this time. I wrote a new tune. Music and notes by me, boys. Get this. This is going to be a snapper, this title. It's called When It's Apple Blossom Time in Corpus Christi.
Thank you. baby don't care for clothes. My baby don't care for shows. My baby just cares for me. My baby don't care for silks and laces. My baby don't care for high-toned places. My baby don't care for rings and other expensive things. She's sensible as can be. My baby don't care who knows it. My baby just cares for me. Care for clothes. My baby don't care for shows. My baby just cares for me. My baby don't care for silks and laces. My baby don't care for high-toned places. My baby don't care for rings and other expensive things. She's sensible as can be. My baby don't care who knows it. My baby just cares for me.
Inside Hollywood. Presenting Hollywood's own beloved, sweet, darling, pretty, vivacious, lovable...
Yes.
Brunella Carsons. Miss Carsons.
Thank you, ugly boy. Good evening, all my friends here in Movie Land. Tonight, instead of my usual drivel... must be a typographical error. They must mean trivia. I'm speaking to you from the sound stages of stupendous pictures, and I want you to look in with me. Shall we be off?
Quiet! Quiet on the set! Quiet!
Somebody's still breathing. Where's my assistant director, Rodney Reel?
Oh, yes, sir. Did you want me, sir?
Reel, you're all wound up. Remember, I'm a busy, busy, busy man directing this picture.
Of course, Monty.
As far as I'm concerned, Reel, you're just about run out. Now. Now, what did I tell you to call me on the set?
You mean what the extras call you?
No, not... Oh, oh. You know.
Yes. Montague Close-Up Muldoon, Director Supreme of Stupendous Pictures, Incorporated.
Well, you can leave off the Incorporated when we're among friends. I'm a busy, busy, busy man. This is no B picture, you know. Have we spent any money lately?
We spent $40,000 just 10 minutes ago.
I said lately. What'd you spend it for, Reel?
A bathing suit for the leading lady.
This is no B picture. Give me that checkbook. I'm going to write out a check for another $40,000. Let's get both pieces to that bathing suit. It's indecent. Reel, have I told you lately that I'm a busy, 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 busy man?
Yes, Mr. Busy. I mean Mr. Muldoon. Now, about this army picture, Mr. Muldoon, I want to tell you something.
Listen, Reel, you can't tell me anything about the army. I know that outfit from A to Z. I was a full colonel in this war, and I spent the entire duration in Washington, D.C. Now, what about that desert scene?
Well, we're having difficulty finding a desert big enough to hold 2,000 troop transports.
Now, listen, if MacArthur could afford to use 1,000 troop transports, stupendous pictures can afford to use 2,000.
But there's no desert big enough.
Well, I told you to buy Death Valley. If you don't hurry, they'll start a housing project out there. Real, you've slipped your spool for the last time with me. I'm taking over the entire production of this picture personally. I promised the Secretary of War that this Army picture would be ready 3 days ago. I'll keep that promise.
Yes, Mr. Muldoon.
Have you got that explosion scene ready?
Yes, sir.
Well,
the bomb men have been working on it for 2 weeks. I think you'll like it.
Well, let's have it. This picture's costing me $1 million a day. It's not long enough. Do it again. Well, I'm off for the desert. Forgot my checkbook. Well, Rio, what's your excuse this time?
Well, Mr. Muldoon,
I don't see a drop of water out here anywhere.
But, Mr. Muldoon...
I told you to flood this entire desert under 26 feet of water. Now, what are we going to do with Esther Williams? In this picture, she won't swim. Well, in this picture, she just won't swim. She'll have to ride a camel, that's all. By the way, I don't see those camels anywhere.
But, Mr. Muldoon...
I suppose you're going to tell me that you forgot. You forgot a little thing like... 30,000 camels. Oh.
Mr. Muldoon, there is something that this Army picture I've been trying to tell you.
Well, Real, you're all mixed up. I know what you mean, though. Is this what you call a crowd? I asked for 100,000 Arabs, but do I get them? No, there's practically nobody out there. Looks like a group of Republicans lined up to vote.
Mr. Muldoon, I've been thinking...
Impossible. Where's the telephone?
Why?
Why, I'll tell you why. I want a crowd out there. I'm going to call Washington. Mr. Truman's the only one that's got 100,000 men not doing anything.
Well, Mr. Muldoon, there's no telephone way out here in the desert.
No, who said so? When Muldoon wants a telephone, Muldoon gets a telephone. Why, there's probably one hanging right here on this banana tree. By the way, Real, where are those banana trees? Well, never mind. You got a nickel?
Here you are, Mr. Muldoon. 5 cents.
Well, this picture's costing us a lot of money. Hello. What number did I dial? Well, how should I know what number I dialed? I'm a busy, busy, busy man. Give me the White House. No, I won't wait. I want the White House. I'm a busy, busy, busy man. Hello, White House. I want to talk to you know who. Is he busy? Yeah, he's busy. I'll call later.
Mr. Muldoon, there's something about this Army picture you ought to know.
Real, you're off the track again. Have I fired you today?
No, Mr. Muldoon.
I haven't? You're fired!
Well, I'll be a second lieutenant.
All right. Now, places, everybody. Hurry up. Is it going to take all day for 300,000 people to get set? You back there, stop blinking your eyes. Now, when I give the signal, all 300,000 of you Arabs run out into that clearing in the desert. Now, the Army planes, wait a minute. Yeah, they're up there circling around. All right. At a signal from me, they'll swoop down and strafe you. They're using real bullets, so be careful. If any of you get mowed down, don't worry. You won't spoil the scene. This is only a rehearsal.
Mr. Muldoon, I just came out to tell you the picture is finished.
It is? Well, that's fine. All you Arabs out there, you can all go home. This Army picture is finished.
There's only one thing wrong, Mr. Muldoon.
Well, what's that, Real?
What I've been trying to tell you all along. This picture was not ordered by the Secretary of War.
It wasn't?
No. No, that letter was from the Secretary of the Navy. This Army picture was supposed to be a Navy picture.
Mm-hmm. It's the blues. It's Midge Williams.
Out on a plane down near Santa Fe, I met a cowboy riding the range one day, and as he jumped along, I heard him singing the most peculiar cowboy song. It was a ditty he learned in the city. Come to I-I-I, come to I-I-I, if I get along. Get hip, little dog, get along. Better be on your way, get along. Get hip, little doggy, and he trucked him on down the old fairway, singing his cow, cow, boogie in the strangest way. Come to I-I-I, come to I-I-I, singing his cowboy song. He's just too much. He's got a knockout western accent with a hunger. He was raised on local meat. He's what you call a thing half breed. Singing his cow, cow, boogie in the strangest way. Come at the I-I-I, come at the I-P-I-I. Why get along? Get hip, little doggy, get along. Better be on your way, get along. Get hip, little doggy, and he trucked him on down the old fairway, singing his cow, cow, boogie in the strangest way. Come at the I-I-I, come at the I-P-I-I, singing his cowboy song. He's just too much. He's got a knockout western accent with that howling cut. He was raised on local heat. He's what you call a swing half-breed. Singing his cow, cow, boogie in the strangest way. Come at the I-I-I, come at the I-P-I-A. Yes, 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 yes. Come at the I-I-P-I-A.
Stand by. Here's the news you've been waiting all week to hear. Here's the news thousands of you want to hear.
Folks, he's talking about the results of our Ginger Peachy contest announced last week. Remember, we told you to write a letter on the subject, how to get the Jack Webb Show off the air.
Didn't work, did it? Well, John, clean your glasses and read the winning letter.
Here it is, Jack. In part, it says, I read from the letter, quote, chapter one entitled The Process of Air Fumigation, or How to Get the Jack Webb Show off the air. The solution is to have each person in the country take deeper and more breaths, and it won't be long until all the air is used up, and then there'll be no air for Webb to be on.
Hmm. How silly.
And it's signed, Betty Ford, Pyramid Court, Sparks, Nevada. Congratulations, Miss Ford.
I hate you, Miss Ford. But enough of these pats on the back for Miss Ford. She wants to know what she's won. By the way, what did she win?
Oh, boy, she won, and how what she won.
Well, what did she win?
Well, Nora McNamara will just put that geometry book away for a minute and come up here.
John, you don't mean we're giving Nora away.
No, Nora has the prize. And
oh,
here it is.
My, look at that thing. A king-size egg. Isn't that beautiful? What is that, John?
It's a genuine ostrich egg, laid fresh this morning from the California Ostrich Farm in Southern California. Yes, friends, this is a Hollywood egg.
Yes, sir. This ostrich egg has been autographed by all members of the cast, including John Galbraith, who makes his usual X. And it has been lacquered and placed on a solid wooden base. And all this, with our best wishes, will be shipped air express to the winner of this week's contest, Betty Ford, Sparks, Nevada. Well, right now. Tonight's egg was laid by the Ragged Airs, Clancy Hastings, and Casey Gessers with a vocal. Midge Williams as guest stars, teed off on a couple of songs. John Galbraith and Ethel Sterling missed their cues. Dick Breen glued the joints together. And this is Jack Webb. Give us another chance next Wednesday night at 9:30, will you? Good night, gang. See you then.
Hi there, this is Bill Bragg, the man with a million friends, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with my good friends Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of The Jack Webb Show. That was Slim Slade, Western Bandleader, from April 17th, 1946, originally over ABC West Coast and KGO. Lovely bit of fluff, wasn't that? You're never going to hear Jack that way again. unless you hear the other episode that we have. Anyway, you know what that reminds me of, too, is that I know we've mentioned it before, but that sketch he did with Johnny Carson.
That was crazy.
I mean, he was on The Tonight Show, and he did a little interview, you know, a sit-down interview, I think. But they also did this little – they just both sat at opposite ends of a table and did this dragnet, you know, interview kind of a thing where Jack playing Joe Friday and Johnny is coming to complain about his clean copper clappers kept in a closet that were copped by Clara Cooper, the cleaning lady. Or belonged to Claude Cooper or something like that. It was a tremendous tongue twister along those lines. And the final tongue twister, and through it all, you see both of them trying not to laugh. You see Carson doing that bit and trying not to break up. And then Webb does the final long tongue twister, a la Fibber McGee. You know, Jim Jordan used to do those all the time and hardly ever got them wrong. Jack went through the whole damn thing. Said, that's about it, isn't it? And Johnny just... He was laughing and nodding, and then he started laughing, and then they cut to Jack Webb, and he was smiling and laughing and going, wow, that really had been the first time I've ever seen Jack Webb have any kind of emotion like that, and that was cool. That's probably who he really was. It was just, you know, he was so into the character of Jill Friday that he was always so straight-laced about it, you know. But that was the character. And Jack also created Project UFO, among many other TV series, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. I'll give myself a plug for one of my other websites later on. Anyway, we've got a lot more featuring Jack Webb coming your way, and we're going to get to all of that and more right after this. Hi, this is Big John.
And this is Steve.
And we're here to tell you about the greatest internet experience you'll ever have. We're talking about the glowing dial page.
That's right. And to get there, all you have to do is simply point your browser to www.glowingdial.com. It couldn't be any easier.
The Glowing Dial page is the internet presence for our old-time radio show, The Glowing Dial.
There are so many things to see and do at The Glowing Dial page, we don't have time to list them all, but here's a few.
Read mini bios of Steve and myself and find out how the show came to be.
Enter our latest contest and win a neat prize.
Browse The Glowing Dial archives and trade some OTR with us.
Visit the photo gallery and view images of Big John and myself, as well as some of our friends and OTR celebrities, too.
Shop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com.
Relax in our listening lounge, where you can hear classic and current episodes of The Glowing Dial, as well as celebrity interviews and other OTR bits and pieces.
Stop by the Glowing Dial online store and purchase a wide variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo.
All that and more await you at the Glowing Dial page at www.glowingdial.com. See you there.
And we're back. I'm Big John, that's Steve, and it is time now for that celebratory portion of the show, and I think, Mr. Urbanek, you are ready for it as you have the...
I am. I have everything ready here.
You have the script right there in front of you.
Yes.
So I think all that's left is for us to...
That's what makes it so thankless and arduous.
Right.
The script.
All that's left is for me to say, and now the music, folks. Gentlemen, once more on the Glowing Dial, it is time for the celebrity birthday list, and here with that thankless, arduous task is Mr. Steve Archiver Bannock. Take it away, sir.
Yes, this is for the celebrity birthday list for the three-week period July 2 to July 22.
You're singing along with it.
I like those ladies, the way they sing. July the 2nd, we start off with Jeff Alexander. He's a conductor. He did Amos and Andy, Light Up Time, and Tums Hollywood Theater. Good for your tummy. July the 3rd, Dorothy Kilgallen. Commentator. She was on Voice of Broadway, Breakfast with Dorothy and Dick, and To Tell the Truth.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
July the 4th, George Trendle, executive, WXYZ-TV in Detroit, the original idea for the Lone Ranger. July the 5th, John Abbott, actor, Lux Radio Theater.
Sesmar.
July the 6th. Sebastian Cabot, actor. We know him from Mr. French from the Family Affair. But he was also on Horizons West, Studio One, and The Lives of Harry Lime. Oh, that's hirsute citrus we always know about, don't we?
The furry lemon goes along with
it. July the 7th gives us Leroy Satchel Paige, Baseball Hall of Famer, Destination Freedom, and we featured him in our baseball salute earlier this week.
Yes.
July the 8th, we had Bill Thompson, actor Wallace Wimple, Horatio K. Boomer, and others on Fibber, McGee, and Molly. July the 9th, Ted Steele, famed band leader on Ted Steele Studio Club and Chesterfield Supper Club. July the 10th, David Brinkley, newscaster, WRC, Washington, D.C., and he did Nightline. July 11th, Walter Wanger, film producer, Information Please, Hollywood Fights Back, Lux Radio Theater. July the 12th, we have Milton Berle, Uncle Milty himself, comedian, Milton Berle Show. He was also on Three Ring Time and Let Yourself Go. July 13th gives us Dave Garraway, another news person, MC and announcer, World's Greatest Novels, Dave Garraway Show, and Dial Dave Garraway.
First host of the Today Show on TV.
Today Show, that's right. I remember him from Today. July the 14th, Ken Murray, comedian, Hollywood Hotel, Texaco Star Theater. July 15th, Marjorie Rambeau, actress. She was on Adventures of Hillary Queen.
No relation to the Stallone character.
No. July 16th, Percy Kilbride, actor and host. He was on Paul Whiteman Presents, Melody Roundup, and he was in
Ma and Pa Cattle.
July 17th, Earl Stanley Gardner, creator and writer. He did The Adventures of Christopher London and Harry Mason. July 18th, Harriet Nelson, actress. She was Daisy June on The Red Skelton Show, and for years was Mrs. Nelson on Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. July the 19th, Juano Hernandez, who was actor Kolu in Jungle Jim. July the 20th, Verna Felton, famed actress. She was Blossom Blimp in Seal Test Village Store and Liz Pierce in The Judy Canova Show. July 21st, Ken Maynard, cowboy actor on The Ken Maynard Show. And we wrap up with July 22nd, Margaret Whiting, singer. She was on Philip Morris Frolics and Barry Wood Show.
All right, Stephen, thank you so much. Very good job, as always. And there you have it, folks. That was the celebrity birthday list for this three-week period here on The Glowing Dial. If that wasn't enough for you, you want more celebrity birthdays? Well, I've got just the thing for you. You go to glowingdial.com, click on birthdays, and there you will see the birthdays for the entire three-week period. Like I say, we can only do one per day here. Otherwise, this bit would be as long as the show. And if you want them for the whole year, at the top of that birthday page is a link to our friend Ron Sales' homepage where he has them for the entire year, and he does his best to keep it updated. So check that out and let Ron know what a good job he's doing over there. All right, Stephen, it is time to introduce our next episode.
Introducing!
Ba-ba-da-bum! Yes, another Jack Webb show. This we get into all of his detective shows now. We're starting with an episode of Johnny Madero, Pier 23. This one is called Fatal Action. It's from June 26, 1947, over Mutual. Stars Jack Webb, Gail Gordon, Bill Conrad, Elaine Burke, Bob Holden, Herb Butterfield, Irvin Lee, Herb Rawlinson, and Tommy Lafrano is announcing the show was sustained. And I believe there is a bit of a write-up there that some Steve's going to pass
on
some information.
Of course, if it's Jack Webb, there's going to be some kind of a write-up on it, because Jack Webb was such a a Hollywood biggie that there would always be. Johnny Madero, Pier 23, was a detective adventure. Okay, that's more in line with Jack Webb's usual types of shows now.
Right.
Okay, broadcast history. It was on April through September of 1947, so it's about a six-month run, on Mutual. And let's see, Johnny Madero came to the air after Jack Webb left San Francisco for Hollywood in 1947. Webb had been playing the title role in Pat Novak, perhaps the most caustic detective of the air. Writer Richard Breen created the character with a bile-dipped pen. The result was a hilarious show and the emergence of Webb as a national radio personality. In Hollywood, Webb and Breen reunited and decided to continue their Novakian adventures. But Novak was unavailable. It was still in production in San Francisco with a new actor, Ben Morris, and a new writer, Gil Dowd, producing a far different sound. Webb and Breen thus created their Novak under another name, Johnny Madero. It was Webb's first coast-to-coast excursion into staccato metaphor. Madero had the same chip on his shoulder, the same snappy comeback. The stories were almost devoid of sensible plots. They existed to serve the one-liners. Each week, Madero consulted Father Leahy, who was a bit devious for a man of the cloth. With a bit of double-dealing, the pair managed to stay ahead of Warchek, the cop, while chasing down the real culprits.
Oh, yes. So maybe we should have presented Pat Novak before this, actually. But
yeah.
We'll have that coming up next, actually. There you go. That's the history in Johnny Madero, Pier 23. And I guess without further ado, we should have you reach over there.
Reach for the sky. No, reach for the McGee machine.
To your boyfriend, the McGee machine. Or is it a girl?
It's my boy toy. I don't know if it's a boy. I have never been able to tell from the knobs if it's a male or a female McGee machine.
Okay, I could go so many places with that, but we just don't have
time. Then
you'd
be stealing the McGee machine and I'd have to call the cops on you.
Exactly. Anyway, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember Johnny Madero, Pier 23. This is Fatal Action from June 26, 1947, originally over Mutual.
Johnny Madero, Pier 23. You know, it doesn't pay to buy a fast car in San Francisco because most of the time you got to be in low gear. The town is laid out like the profile of a chorus line, and the only time it flattens out is where it runs into the bay. The waterfront goes from south of the ferry building out past the China docks, and on a clear day, you can see them batting baseballs over on Alcatraz. Pier 23 is over toward the left field sign, and not far from there, you'll find Johnny Madero's boat shop. My place. Oh, I rent boats, and I do anything else that means long odds and short hours. It's a way to make a living. And if you never save enough to get married, at least you got enough to leave town. Maybe I should have left town Monday afternoon. I bought a paper, and I read about a buildup on a heavyweight fight in L.A. I stopped in at Lofty's, and the boy said neither one of those fighters could beat an egg with a power drill. About 3 o'clock, I started down Post Street when I spotted a new auction house. It was small, with enough dough changing hands to buy back Manhattan Island. Inside, it was packed, and up on a wooden stand, a bald-headed guy was selling everything but his suspenders. So I sat down in back, and I noticed a girl standing up against the wall. She was wearing dark green sunglasses, but the rest of her was just about as secret as a plow on the bathroom floor. Her hair was the color of half past midnight, and her dress was made of the kind of goods you buy from spiders. After a while, she walked over to me. Right away, she started to get nervous, and when you look like her, you got a right to be.
Mind if I sit down?
They're your legs, lady. If you want to rest them, rest them.
Thanks. You seem to like the view.
Just temporary. I'm leaving.
Will you get excited if I ask you to stay?
Are you going
to
be proud if I do?
Please. I want you to do me a favor. It won't take long. It'll be a small one.
How small?
They're going to auction off a black leather suitcase in a few minutes. It belongs to me. I must have it back.
You speak the language. Do your own bidding, huh?
I don't want someone to know I'm here. It's important. I'll pay you $50 to bid for me.
You just hired me.
Just start bidding and keep on bidding till you get that suitcase. I want it at any price.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here's a special item of interest. A black leather suitcase. Arrived yesterday. Contents unknown. It's handsome. It's beautiful. It's never been opened. Now, who's got sporting blood? The leather alone is worth at least $25, and it's heavy, it's heavy. It could be full of bricks, and it could be full of gold. That's what makes it interesting. Now, who's going to start the bidding? Who's going to start it off with a big one?
$2.
Come on, that's an insult. $2? Who'll give 15?
$10.
10. Who'll give 30? 10. Who'll give 30?
Start pitching for our team, mister.
$25.
50. 50.
Double it.
100.
100. The man in the gallery bids 100. You heard him, folks? 100. We'll give 2.
200.
200.
You got competition, lady.
I got you. Keep doubling.
400.
400. That man in the gallery's got second vision. He knows what the suitcase is worth. The bid's 400. We'll give 800. 4. We'll give 8.
800.
800. The man in front here says 8. We'll give 1,000. The bid's 800. We'll give 1,000.
Go ahead. Surprise the man.
The OPA won't like this.
You're working for me now. Make it 1,000.
$1,000.
Oh, man, I'm back. Bitch, $1,000. Who'll get 1,500? 1,000. Who'll get 1,500? All right. 1,000 once. 1,000 twice.
1,000 for the third and last time. All through bidding. Sold to the men in the galley. Please come up and claim this prize now.
Here's the money. Pick it up and come back. I'll be waiting.
Get out.
And don't let him open it. Whatever you do, don't let him open it.
It's your party, lady. I won't even let him peek.
Ah, there's the lucky man coming down the aisle now. Give him room. Give him room. Ah, here he is. And here's your suitcase, mister. Want to open it and tell the folks what's inside?
Yeah, what's in it, Mac?
Just one of my relatives. Here's the dough.
Yeah, sure. All right. Now we have another item here.
Oh. Sorry, son. I was just going for the empty seat.
Yeah, we'll wait for your blockers next time, Pop. Where's the girl, the brunette with the dark glasses?
It's a jail term, son. I don't follow him home anymore.
Well, she was here a minute ago. You must have seen her leave.
No.
Think about it. She must have walked right past you. Think about it.
No, son. When you get to be my age, you don't even do that.
I felt kind of silly, the same way you do when you find a hole in your sock at the shoe store. But it wasn't my dough that bought that case, so I couldn't beef much. When I got back to the office, I started working on the lock with the key. The case was made of plain black leather, and it was kicked around more than Minnie's gong. Then I opened it. A shiny-looking saxophone was laid out in three parts. For $1,000, you can buy a whole brass section. So I went through each piece looking for a reason. There was a paper box inside the case. It had a gross of reeds in it. Same kind you find on the mouthpiece of any saxophone. I couldn't do much more, so I wrapped up the case and put it up in my closet. Then the door opened, and if trouble had a face, this was the way it looked in the morning. He stood there in the middle of the room, and his eyes held me like a fly at the end of two needles. You noticed his eyebrows. They were bushy and thick, and if they got any worse, he'd have to hire a native guide.
Hello, are you Madero?
That's my story. You got a better one?
It's sadder than yours. I'm the guy you left behind at the auction. Who are you bidding for?
Who are you asking for?
Myself.
I suppose we get real friendly. What's your name?
Dunlap, Larry Dunlap. Now, introduce me to the girl who was coaching you.
All right. She was a souped-up brunette with a disappearing act. Now, what does that prove?
Unless you find her in a cemetery, never trust a woman. Especially Claire Underwood.
Yeah. What do you want from me?
I'll take that black leather suitcase you won at the auction.
Look, I saved you some dough. Don't make a pig of yourself. Try to be nice.
I will. I won't kick you when you're dead. Where's that suitcase? You're making me nervous.
So if you got an itch, see a doctor. What makes you so big?
Vitamins. I know all about the sax, Madero. It belongs to me. Give it to me or I start looking.
You better have a license. The sax isn't that important.
It is to me. Maybe I want to start a hock shop.
I'll hold out for your girlfriend. She owes me $50 and I need the dough.
I'll double anything she gives you.
If you mean money, give me a hint.
Will $100 do?
Yeah. The sax is in the closet on top here. Come on. Give me a hand.
Sure. You've got a hand, Madero. Now play it out.
Some days you're not going to make out any better than an ice cube at a cocktail party. When Dunlap hit me, I folded up and my head got the size of a social worker's heart. Well, I started tossing around on the rug. It took me longer to stop than it took Haig to quit Jersey. I knew that sax was gone, so there was no point in getting up. I started dreaming about that day a Cleveland bellhop gave me a key to the wrong room. It was going all right, too, until somebody began shaking me. In that small room, I didn't have to look up to know who it was, because Inspector Warcheck of San Francisco Homicide is the kind of guy you stand next to in a hurricane and wonder what happened to the ventilation.
Making a wish, Madero?
Yeah, here, so it didn't come true. What are you collecting?
Alibis. What's yours for last night at 12 o'clock?
I was in bed.
You got a witness?
No, you can't win them all.
Yeah, that's the way a guy named Charlie Reiser felt.
So maybe it's an epidemic.
So maybe you started it. Someone shot him dead. The guy was a musician.
Try some of the neighbors.
I'll try you first.
You're reaching, Warcheck. I never even heard of the guy.
Oh, that's a handicap, Madero. Maybe you just heard of his instrument, huh?
All right, let me guess. It was a sax.
Hey, you're very bright. An auctioneer helped me trace it down to you. Now, what's the pitch?
A wild one, Warcheck. A dame forced me to do her a favor.
Uh-huh. I bet you force easy.
She paid me to bid for the sax and then took a potter after I won it.
You got an active memory. Does it include a name?
Yeah. Claire Underwood. Run it down and see what it gets you.
Oh, now stop threatening me, Madero. I think that sax is tied in with the murder. Now, where is it?
You're a little late. A torpedo named Larry Dunlap just walked in and sapped me for it.
Yeah? How hard did he sap you, Madero?
Hmm?
There's a pool of blood behind your desk, and it doesn't look like yours. How'd it get there?
I don't know, Warcheck. Maybe somebody got lost and figured it was a blood bank. How do I know?
Yeah. Maybe they thought it was a morgue, too. Left a body. Now look around.
Yeah, do that. Look under the rug, too. Maybe the guy was thin.
All right, Madero. So far, you're in the clear. But if there's blood, there must be a body close by. It'll show. When it does, we'll turn it in for yours.
I'll remember.
Like you remember that $1,000?
Huh?
The auction house, Madero. The $1,000 you gave the joint got homesick and left.
I'm broke, Warchick.
Yeah?
You'll have to stand on your head to pin this on me.
Maybe I will.
Maybe you're right. I forgot about your head. Once Warchick sticks to you, you might as well try to pull a mustard plaster off a throw rug. He stood there for a minute, blinking at the light, and you could see big pebbles of sweat standing out on his forehead. He took a handkerchief out of his pocket, and when it came down, it was wet enough to wash all the windows in Lower Manhattan. After a while, he walked out. I watched him out of the window. I tried to figure how I got into this. It was like trying to trace back a conversation to see what words started it. There were lots of questions, and not too much time. Why was a saxophone and a grocer Reed's worth all that dough? And who left his blood on my rug as a deposit? The girl must have known what was in the case, but why did she leave it with me? I couldn't make it add up, so I looked up the only good guy I know, a waterfront priest named Father Leahy. He knows most of the bad boys around the piers, and he's heard enough sins to start an art colony. Around Lofty's, they got his name above the line, and that's a tough trick, because along the waterfront, an archangel couldn't get a cup of coffee without hucking a wing. I found him over at the parish house having dinner.
Hello, Johnny. You want some wine?
No, thanks, Father.
That's one of the good things about this job. You get wine with your meals.
Yeah, I know.
Except you got to watch out. I knew a guy in the seminary liked to eat between meals.
Yeah, yeah.
But the bishop fixed him. He sent him to a rich parish, and the guy had to throw away half his sermons.
I'm in trouble, Father.
Did you buy elevator shoes, or is that a bump on your head?
Somebody knocked me down when I wasn't looking.
Did you get the license number?
It just felt like a truck. I got hit with a club. That's why I want you to help me, Father.
Johnny, you misinterpret my mission in life. You need a policeman. I'm only a priest. Besides, I'm eating.
Look, Father, homicide wants to tack a murder on me.
There goes my appetite. Who's dead? Anybody I could have helped?
His name was Charlie Reiser. He was a musician.
If he's going in the right direction, he may get some work. How did you meet him?
I didn't. I never heard of the guy. It was all a surprise to me.
Sounds more like a shock.
I got a bum shake from the start, Father. A gal with a big purse promised to pay me something if I'd bid for a black suitcase at an auction.
What was the matter with her? Laryngitis?
She was trying to keep somebody from noticing her, but she must have weakened in the final stretch.
What do you mean?
I won the bid with $1,000, but when I came back, the gal was gone.
And you were left holding the bag. What was in it?
A saxophone and a grocer Reed's. You could buy the whole outfit with a $5 down payment.
What makes it worth $1,000?
I don't know, Father. The sax belonged to Charlie Reiser. A guy named Dunlap offered me $200 for it.
All that money for a saxophone, and they wouldn't allow me $40 on that old organ.
Dunlap slugged me when my back was turned, piled up a lead.
Did the sax go for free?
Somebody paid for it. When I woke up, there was a lot of blood on the floor.
Yours?
It was unclaimed, but I have an idea a body's going to turn up without it.
You have nothing but murder on your mind, Johnny. Why don't you settle down with a good book?
If Warchick tags me, I'll have to borrow yours, Father. Right now, I need you to check on a few people for me.
Sure, but I'll need a couple of names for them first.
You know a lot of the combo boys, Father. Check up on Charlie Reiser's friends, especially his women. And find out where Larry Dunlap fits in. Will you do it, Father?
Yes, Johnny, I'll do it. But if I find out you're calling him wrong, I'll drop over to Warchick's side.
Thanks, Father. If you help me out of this, you're a good guy. You're an angel.
But stop pushing me. I'm not that anxious yet.
When I left Father Leahy, I ran over my leads. You could have counted them on one finger, and you'd still have to cheat. The only guy worth looking up was the auctioneer on Eddy Street. Maybe that was all revenge. Why did he tell Warchick that I took that $1,000 back? Well, I figured I'd find out, so I grabbed a cab back to his store. When I got there, the joint was locked up, but a big neon sign blinked the name J.C. Cole. There was another light coming from the back, so I followed it down. Inside, Cole was working over his cash register tape. I didn't knock, and right away he started making funny noises in his throat. I noticed he was wearing a vest without a tie, and his sleeves were rolled up with big rubber bands. His elbows stuck out, and they were red and knotted up like a baby's face with cramps. And then he made his opening bid.
It's a little late. What can I sell you, mister?
A straight story.
Huh?
The one you told headquarters had too many frills.
Hey, wait a minute. You're the same fellow who bought that suitcase.
You got a good head, friend. How good is it on robbery?
It was dark. I thought it was you, so I called the cops.
You started fast, but you're fading in the stretch.
$1,000 was gone. I figured you took your money back.
That's an early mistake. It wasn't my dough.
You sound like you're mad. Is that a gun in your pocket?
If it makes you talk about that suitcase, I'll say yes.
I don't know what you mean. I said you were taking your chances. A ton of bricks, a ton of gold, remember? I got to make a living, you know.
You don't have to crowd them in. What gives the sacks a $1,000 price tag?
I don't know, I tell you. I don't know what thing.
Yeah, well, we'll go into politics later. I think you're lying.
It was just another suitcase, an old leather suitcase with the sacks inside. I just tell you, I don't know a thing.
Yeah, keep it up, fella. You'll tell me everything that way. Now, how did you know there was a sacks in that case if you never opened it?
Well, Now, listen, mister, let's be friends. I got a little money. Let's be friends.
Go on.
I was just trying to get a little ahead. I got a wife and a kid, a big kid, so I switched saxophones. I took out the original sax with the reeds and put in an older one.
What'd you do with the original?
It was a pretty nice one, brand new. So I sold it to someone, reeds and all, for $200.
You're slowing down. Who's someone, a relative?
He's a friend named Bud, Bud Overbeck. He plays tenor sax at the Downbeat Club. That original was something special, huh?
Yeah, you should have held out for $1,000 on both ends.
Now, listen, fella, Bud's a friend, a good friend on my wife's side. You won't hurt him, will you?
I'll send you a pint if he believes.
Yeah, sure. I'll save it. Anything else, huh?
Yeah. Stop stuttering. You'll give that kid of yours a complex. When he opened the door, you could tell he wanted to shake me worse than a summer cold. I didn't like him any better, but he'd given me something solid to work on. So I got over to the club Downbeat. It's a jazz cellar that warms over King Oliver at 6 bits a throw. Five-piece combo was writing a chorus slow and easy, and you knew the only notes they ever read were on IOUs. There were a dozen or so jazz fans huddled around the bandstand, and if you looked real close at their faces, you saw something that looked like pain. I asked the bartender who Overbeck was, and he pointed out the blonde kid with a face made of warm putty playing a black saxophone. I walked backstage to a small dressing room where the boys grabbed their second wind with a short one. When I opened the door, Claire Underwood stood there holding her breath.
Hello, Johnny. You look angry. Put away those daggers,
I will, baby. I'll guess that you killed Reiser for a saxophone.
Guess again. Why should I kill anyone for a sax?
Tell me why it's worth a grand, and I'll answer that one, too.
All right, Johnny. I'm sentimental. Say Charlie Reiser was my boyfriend, and I wanted to keep his sax as a memory.
Must have been quite a memory, baby.
You didn't meet Charlie.
But I did meet Larry Dunlap. He wanted the sax, too. Why?
How would I know, Johnny? Maybe he was taking lessons.
They weren't that kind. He has too good a lip.
So have I. Only I use it differently.
All right, stop puckering, sweetheart. I want some sense now.
Please, Johnny. If you leave now, I'll give you double what I owe you from the auction.
That's not enough. Look, baby, count up your bills and tell me what a murder rap is worth, huh?
We'll haggle over it later, Johnny. Just meet me at the Ajax Hotel, and I promise you, you'll get a better figure.
Yeah. You going to add some interest?
Come here and I'll show you what I need.
I'm not running a service. I need some answers. Come on. I want some action. Come on.
And use your arms, Johnny.
You got too big a mouth, baby. Somebody's going to close it on you.
Show me, Johnny.
All right.
Oh, the music stopped, Johnny.
What do you care? We're not dancing.
Johnny, please, you're squeezing me too tight.
Yeah, it's a bad habit. Now tell me about that sax.
Listen to me, Johnny. I told you I've got to see Overbeck first. I'll tell you everything later.
Yeah, after you talk Overbeck out of his sacks, huh?
Yes. Is it a deal?
You're too anxious to sign. I'll talk to Overbeck myself.
All right, Johnny. I'll help you get him here quicker.
Yeah, what are you going to do?
Scream, Johnny. Scream. Listen.
Help! 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 Somebody help me!
Louder, baby. You'll really need it in a minute.
Help!
What's she screaming about, mister?
She couldn't catch me.
This man's drunk. He was trying to snatch my purse.
Is that true, mister?
Call a cop and find out.
Yeah, I will.
No, please, don't bother. Just get him out. Just throw him out, Mr. Overbeck.
You heard the lady, mister. Do I get rough?
Save your strength, Overbeck. You'll need it later. Claire had a nice act, if you didn't mind playing straight man to a vulture. She draped herself on Overbeck's arm, and she looked as cool as a vacation in Maine. As I walked out, Overbeck was still showing his teeth, but it didn't matter, because you got the idea he wasn't strong enough to fight off a sneeze. Well, there wasn't much I could do except wait for Claire to show, but it started to drizzle, so I figured my best bet was her hotel. In the lobby, a rose-colored carpet with a touch of yellow jaundice led to the desk. The clerk told me she hadn't come in yet, but for $5 he could tell I was a friend. He gave me her key. I went upstairs, and when I opened Claire's door, I knew something was wrong. A lot of towels were thrown all over the floor, and everything was gone from the closet but the mothballs. Claire had skipped, and before I could walk out, Dunlap walked in. One hand was in his pocket, and the other had enough tape to wrap up a mummy.
Can I come in, madame?
You're old enough, Dunlap. Make up your own mind.
I have. Where's Claire?
You're early. I think she's still busy.
Give me a magazine. I'll wait.
It'll be a long one. I'm not hanging around.
Oh, the fun's just beginning. Sit down. Sit down.
I guess I am tired.
Yeah, this gun makes everybody drowsy. Now, what's your time with Claire?
Nothing that's deep-rooted? Are you writing a column?
Yeah, the obituary, and you're going to make the morning deadline.
You're too cocky, Dunlap. Don't turn your back.
I won't. Claire blew her chance. The best she could do was this arm.
Yeah, you ruined my carpet.
When they pass your cup around, I'll be generous. In the meantime, you're going to stick around until Claire brings that black saxophone.
I hope she's got some food in the icebox.
What do you mean?
Well, if you're waiting for that sax, we're going to starve to death. Claire's not going to show.
What makes you a prophet?
A guy named Bud Overbeck. He had the sax last, and Claire was working him over for it.
I'll work you over for less. What are the rest of her plans?
She was warm. Maybe she left a smoke signal.
All right. You're getting too stubborn.
Put away the gun, Dunlap. You can only use one arm.
I'll clean the bases with this index finger. Pick a spot to fall.
Hey, don't clutter up the floor now, Dunlap. We got company.
Hey, what's this? The wrong room? Claire said we'd be alone.
We are. Just the three of us.
Who's he, Madero?
Huh? What are you talking about? Claire told me to come here. She told me to wait for her.
Look, fella, save your lip for another chorus. Just tell me where she left you.
I don't feel so good. She was at the Downbeat Club. She was helping me put my sacks away. I just came up here to wait. We were going to be alone.
All right, fella. I'm cutting down the crowd. You're with Madero now. I'm leaving.
Yeah, I'm going home, too. I feel sick. I'm going home.
You'll never make it on your knees. What's the matter?
I don't know. I guess I gave the new horn too big a ride tonight. I got a weak heart.
Your eyes aren't too strong either. You're walking right into that closet.
They told me not to play so hard. Maybe I played too hard. Help me, fella. You look familiar. I seen you somewhere, huh? You look fuzzy.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel sick. Someone must have slipped me something. I never felt like this before. I'm sick. Real sick,
You'll never get any sicker, fella. Overbeck was dead even before he had a chance to see if Gabriel paid his boy's scale. He hit the floor and turned over on his back, and you figured he'd cross the River Jordan with a backstroke. I got a good look at him now. His face was all twisted up like bedsheets after a nightmare, and up near his hairline, a long, thin scar ran into his scalp. Well, I didn't know what killed Overbeck, but whatever it was, he didn't get 2 weeks' notice. I figured if homicide caught me here, I'd get my walking papers, too, right down to the last 20 feet. I started for the door, but Warchick opened it for me. He looked at the body and then over to me.
You on a spree, Madero?
If you're footing the bill, Warchick.
The state will from now on. Now, tell me about the guy on the floor.
He's dead.
Must have had parents. What's his name?
Bud Overbeck. He was a musician at the Downbeat Club.
Yeah. Tell me some more.
Roll him, Warchick. Maybe he's got a diary.
All right. Here's his wallet. All right, Madero. How long you been here?
Why?
The wallet's empty.
Well, that's too bad. Your girlfriend's going to have to get along in last week's presents.
I trail a guy named Dunlap up to this apartment, and I find you and a dead body. Now, there's a tie, any way you look at it. Mm-hmm. Now, just what happened?
I don't know, Warchick. I didn't see the picture. I just tagged by for the end. You know?
Must have been a sad one. I think he's poisoned. I like the look in his eyes.
Get the girl who put it there.
Well, just give me a hint, huh?
Overbeck was playing caveman with Claire Underwood before he came up here.
What does that give him besides hair?
Maybe a Mickey. When I left, she was warming up an argument for his saxophone.
She get it?
She didn't. Dunlap's losing man hours. He just walked out of here, and I think she's on his list.
Yeah. I'm beginning to get an idea now myself.
Does it hurt?
You and the Underwood girl are running some kind of a racket for that saxophone. She left you behind the front for her.
You haven't seen her, Warchick. She doesn't need that kind of help.
But you will when I get through checking. Still got a few calls to make, and I want the lab to work over the body. By then, I'll have enough to come back and hold you, Madero.
You couldn't hold a lap dog with a suction pump.
All right, big shot. I'll go a long way to get you for this, a long way.
You got the drag, Warchick.
Yeah. It's going to slow you down a little.
Warchick wanted to mother the body until the coroner came, and when I left, he was squeezing himself into a chair. He fit tighter than a whale in a crib. You could word it any way you like, but the big riddle was that saxophone. Claire had it, and Dunlap wanted it, and a couple of guys died for it. My only alibi was Dunlap, but you might as well ask Kahn to hold still for Lewis. I buzzed back to the office, but there was no message from Father Leahy, so I stared out the window for a while, wondering how to bake a cake with a dynamite charge when the phone rang. Yeah?
Hello, Johnny. This is Father Leahy.
What'd you find out, Father?
It's not pleasant, Johnny. I'm down at the morgue. A lab report on Bud Overbeck just came in.
He died of poisoning, huh, Father?
The bitter kind. Overbeck's heart couldn't stand all that dope.
Hmm?
Coroner found a used saxophone reed in Overbeck's pocket. It was soaked in hop.
So that's what made that saxophone so big. The grosser reeds.
That's right, Johnny. Overbeck was absorbing the stuff while he played.
Oh.
He probably never knew what hit him.
Well, what about Reiser? How does he figure?
Reiser was making his pin money peddling dope to nightclubs. He He's getting his shipments from Mexico.
How did Claire and Dunlap figure?
They were a couple of partners who wanted to ease out Risa and go into business for themselves.
The idea must have gone to Claire's head. She's doing a solo now, and Dunlap thinks she has the sacks.
Warcheck feels the same way about you, Johnny. He's out to tag you for everything.
He's smarter than that.
I don't know him that well. But it adds up in his book because he thinks you're leaving town.
Hmm?
Someone's booked a passage on the 2 a.m. plane from Mexico this morning in the name of Jay Madero.
I'm being jockeyed, Father. It's either Claire or Dunlap. They're both as black as sin.
Maybe so, but Warcheck still thinks you're the dark horse.
Up until now, it was like trying to sell a toupee to a ball-headed eagle. But when the turn comes, everything happens in a hurry, and you began breaking more records than a disc jockey with a hangover. If Father Leahy was right, Claire or Dunlap had enough dreams in that saxophone to start a waltz contest, and I knew if they both got out of town, Warcheck would be around to tag me for the last dance. So I got out to Mills Field, and out on the far end of the strip, a twin-engine plane was warming up. Claire was standing with her back toward me, and even from here, you could see what a stiff tailwind could do to a landing gear. When she saw me, she raised her eyebrows and figured her temperature was even higher.
Sorry I had to borrow your name, Johnny.
You're too small for it, baby.
I got a big ego.
And that gun bolsters it, huh?
That's my story.
Well, tell it to Homicide. They'll take a nibble on either you or Dunlap.
Better throw them Dunlap. I got a date in Mexico City.
It's a blind one, baby. You're going in the wrong direction.
Larry, what are you doing here? I thought you...
I want those reeds, baby.
You'll be peddling pencils when I'm through with you.
I'll leave the sights, too, baby. I'll be lonely.
You won't need that kind of music where you're going, Larry.
You're the ones I told, baby. I trusted you. We were going to do this together. I trusted you.
We all make mistakes. You got the short end.
I'll stretch it a little. You got another chance. Let's team up again.
Sorry, Larry. I'm crowding you out.
You only think so.
Now get out of my way. I got to make the plane.
Make a grave first. I want that stuff.
I won't miss again. Stay away, Larry.
Put up a sign.
Yeah.
You missed again. Give me the gun.
No, I'm selfish. I'll hold on. Pull him off me, Madera. Pull him off.
There's a lot.
All right, baby. You run out of chances. It's my turn now.
No. Please, Larry. Put the gun away. You win. I'll split it with you now. You win. Honest, Larry, you win.
Just to show you I agree.
You're through, guy. Drop the gun.
Yeah. Now, what are the odds of my getting away in that plane?
70-30, maybe.
Things are too tough at 50-50. Come on, I'll ride downtown with you.
While Dunlap told the whole story down at headquarters, it seems that Reiser, Claire, and he were buying dope from Mexico and peddling it here in the form of soaked-up reeds. Reiser was contact man in Mexico, but the only way they knew him down there was by his black saxophone. Claire and Dunlap decided to narrow the profits down to two by shooting Reiser and taking over. Claire used the gun, and, well, that started her to thinking that she could do even better with a single act. She needed that black sax, though. Reiser got wind of it and hid the sax with the reeds in the basement. His landlady found it after he was tumbled and sold it to that auction house. And Claire had me buy it and followed me back to the office where she tried to peg down Dunlap. The sax she took turned out to be a phony because the auctioneer had already sold the black one to Bud Overbeck. The track was switched to him, but not soon enough. Overbeck didn't know the reeds were loaded, and after an all-night jam session, he folded up with a heart attack. Well, Warcheck asked only one question. Wasn't it tough luck for an innocent guy like Overbeck? I don't know. At least there was one time he played right out of this world.
Johnny Madero, Pier 23, starring Jack Webb as Johnny Madero, has been presented by the Mutual Network. Johnny Madero is written by Herb Margolis and Lou Morheim. Gail Gordon played Father Leahy, and Bill Conrad played Inspector Warcheck of Homicide. Others in the cast were Helene Burke, Bob Holton, Herb Butterfield, Irvin Lee, and Herb Rawlinson. Original music was composed and conducted by Harry Zimmerman, and the entire production was directed by Nat Wolf. We invite you to listen again next week over most of these stations when Mutual presents another adventure in the life of Johnny Madero, Pier 23. Tony Lafrano speaking.
This program came to you from Hollywood. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Hello there. This is CBS Radio Mystery Theater's Gordon Gould. You are listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Johnny Madero Pier 23 that was called Fatal Action, and it was from June 26, 1947, originally over Mutual. And we have three more shows featuring Jack Webb in this web page edition of The Glowing Dial. We're going to get to all of that and more right after this. Hi, folks. This is Big John.
And Steve. And we're here to tell you about three fantastic websites that are very near and dear to us here at The Glowing Dial.
The first one is Yesterday USA Radio's Superstation Online. This is the station that gave Steve and I our start broadcasting old-time radio on the Internet. Yesterday USA can be found at www.yesterdayusa.com. Utilizing an all-volunteer staff and operating entirely by financial contributions from the listeners, Yesterday USA presents a wide variety of old-time radio and live programming 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. A visit to the Yesterday USA website features an abundance of OTR-related information. You can learn about the station and its founder, Bill Bragg. You can get a program schedule and even listen to the station online as you surf the site. If you should decide to support YUSA, you'll have access to a fantastic members-only area, which features an expanded program guide, web camera feed, and the Sam Grossman Memorial Chat Room. All that and much more awaits you at the official Yesterday USA homepage at www.yesterdayusa.com.
The second site is Jerry Handiga's Vintage Radio Place, which can be found at www.otrsite.com. There's so much to see and do here, we only have time to mention a few things. This monster site features hundreds of vintage radio logs, OTR articles, and OTR links. You can even purchase radio programs from Jerry's extensive collection. The site also features a link to the Old Time Radio Network, where you may hear episodes of Same Time, Same Station, Heritage Radio Theater, and The Glowing Dial, all brought to you in streaming real media. You can also listen to archived previous broadcasts of the aforementioned shows. All that and much more await you at Jerry Handiga's Vintage Radio Place at www.otrsite.com.
The third and final site is Stay Tuned America, which is run by our good friend Corey Harker. It can be found at www.staytunednetworks.com. Stay Tuned America is your classic entertainment superstation and features classic big band music and old-time radio programs. You can listen to the station's high-quality MP3 Pro audio stream while you peruse their program guide, where you will find shows like the original Big Band Showcase with Denny Farrell, John Rayburn's Big Band Bash, The Don Kennedy Show and Big Band Jump, Fred Hall's Swing Thing, Radio Revisited with Don Corey, The Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve, and USA Radio Network News at the top of every hour. All that and more at your classic entertainment superstation, Stay Tuned America, at www.staytunednetworks.com.
So take the time to visit all three of these fantastic websites. Drop them a note of support and tell them Big John and Steve sent you.
And we are back. I'm Big John, that's Steve, and it's time for our next show featuring Jack Webb as a hard-boiled detective. This is an episode of Pat Novak for Hire. We just spoke of that a little earlier in comparison to our last show, Johnny Madero. This episode of Pat Novak for Hire is called Fleet Lady, and it was broadcast March 6, 1949 over ABC West Coast and KGO, and it stars Jack Webb, Tudor Owens, Raymond Burr, Virginia Gregg, Tall Avery, Stacey Harris, Hugh Thomas, and Carlisle Bibbers. George Fenneman is announcing, and the show is sustained. Now, I want you to listen at the very end of this episode for a couple of interesting bloopers, and we'll talk about it after the show there, unless actually Steve might end up reading it. I'm not sure if it's in the write-up there or not, but Steven, please, out of that wonderful John Dunning book, On the Air, The Encyclopedia of Old-Time Radio, which is available from the Glowing Dial bookstore, hint, 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 through our association with Amazon.com, please tell us about Pat Novak for Hire.
Pat Novak for Hire is a detective drama. And broadcast history, it began in 1946. ABC on the West Coast produced at KGO San Francisco. and aired on the West Coast and went national through June of 1949. Pat Novak was Jack Webb's first significant radio crime drama. It was also the vanguard of radio hard-edge, so hard-boiled as to be high camp in its own time. The show was rich with hilarious pessimism, rippling with ridiculous metaphors. The street was as deserted as a warm bottle of beer, Novak would say. The car started up down the street, and the old man couldn't have made it with a pocket full of aces. I caught a glimpse of the license plate in a dull, surprised way, the way you would grab a feather out of an angel's wing. In two separate stands as Pat Novak, Webb was propelled as national prominence. Novak operated out of Pier 19, a small office where I rent boats and tell a few white lies if the price is right. Writer Richard Breen, who is Jack's partner, which I mentioned earlier.
Right.
Richard Breen wrote the kind of dialogue that Webb delivered better than anyone else. It was sassy, brassy, and full of pent-up anger. I'll give you $200 to follow a woman, a client says. In a heartbeat, Novak bounces back. How'll I spot her? Read her off an ankle bracelet? At the end of the case, the woman falls to her death, filling the air with a horrible scream as she leaps over the embankment. Too bad her name wasn't Jill, Novak said with only a slight hint of pity. The series existed, in fact, simply to push the one-liners. Each story was exactly like all the others. They all opened up the same general pattern. That's what the sign out in front of my office says, Pat Novak for hire. That's the only way to make a living down on the waterfront in San Francisco, because around here, a set of morals won't cause any more stir than Mother's Day in an orphanage. And it wouldn't do any good to build a church down here, because some guy would muscle in and start cutting the wine with wood alcohol. Well, I rent boats and do anything else that'll buy a warm winter. But if anything goes wrong, your trouble comes hard, and it doesn't do any good to sing the blues, because down here you're just another guy in the chorus. I found that out Wednesday afternoon.
Yeah. Well, there you go. So what you're about to hear is probably going to be very similar to what you have already heard with Johnny Madero.
Very similar.
Because Johnny Madero came after Pat Novak, so we probably should have played those in reverse order. But, you know, that's the crazy kind of guys we are here at the Glowing Dial. We just like to keep you on your toes and, you know, surprise you every now and again. So anyway, let's tune this in for the folks, Stephen. And don't forget to listen at the very end of the show for the couple of bloopers. They're rather entertaining.
We'll explain after, but yeah.
You explain somewhat afterwards.
Yes,
yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So reach for the McGee machine, sir.
Okay.
You've doing that. Very good.
Pat Novak.
Green Eye looks like it's getting ready to tune this in. Yeah, it's getting closer.
I'll punch it in the eye.
Oh, no. Be nice to our McGee machine. I'll punch you in the eye. I won't blame it if it punched you back. Anyway, folks, sit back.
Win.
Close your eyes and remember, Pat Novak for hire. This is Fleet Lady from March 6, 1949, originally over ABC West Coast and KGO.
Ladies and gentlemen, the American Broadcasting Company brings to its entire network one of radio's most unusual programs. Pat Novak for hire.
Sure, I'm Pat Novak for hire. That's what the sign out in front of my office says, Pat Novak for hire. You gotta put it in block letters, because down on the waterfront in San Francisco, there's a price tag on everything. You gotta do that or marry a rich widow. I don't like to work that hard, so I rent boats and do anything else that's cash and carry. Oh, it's all right if you don't mind trouble, because that's one thing you can't duck. It's like trying to dance the minuet in skis. And the best trouble always looks good from the outside. You're all smiles and feel like a kid opening a hand grenade under the Christmas tree. I found that out Tuesday night. It was around 7 o'clock. I was getting ready to close the office when this little guy showed up. He was about the size of a golf bag with arms. And if he had a cigar box, he could see over a pool table. He walked up to the desk and started talking in a voice that made you think he was trying to put Lily Pons out of work.
Hello, you Novak?
You're doing all right so far. What's on your mind?
I'm Jackie Gregg. You heard of me, huh?
You're the shy type, I know.
I'm Jackie Gregg, the jockey. You heard of me, huh?
All right, now I heard of you. Put the show on the road.
I'm looking for a horse. You want to find me a horse?
Yeah, I breed them in the back room. What color do you want?
You're so tough, I got to take that from you?
Calm down before you wind up in a boys' choir. If you got anything to sell, put it on the line or beat it.
I'm riding a horse tomorrow called Fleet Lady. She's disappeared.
She's not here.
I'm supposed to ride the sixth race with her tomorrow. The Bonanza Handicap, and she's gone.
All right, she's gone. Maybe your horse likes to go out at night. I haven't seen her. Get to the point.
I'll give you $200 to find that horse. Somebody took her in a van. I trailed her down here at the waterfront.
But you lost him up at the ferry building.
That's right. Something funny's going on. My mom disappeared, and you gotta find her.
This is a big waterfront, and where's the $200?
You'll get that all right. Down by Pier 19. The van turned in. Think you can find Fleet Lady?
I don't know. Who owns her?
Woman named Sybil Thornton. She's mixed up, I think.
Yeah. Why steal your own horse?
I don't know. Run a ringer, maybe.
That's a tough trick.
This woman's got some good ones. You want the $200?
Yeah. How are the odds?
What's the difference? You're going to open a book? You better take the $200 now.
Yeah, the dough will keep. You sound frightened, Junior.
And you sound nosy. Here's the $200. I want you to find the horse. You let me know at the Kingston Hotel, huh?
Sure.
And if you don't find anything around the waterfront, maybe you better try the track. Ask around there.
Yeah. By the way, how do you fit in? How come you got $200 interest in that horse?
Maybe I love horses. What do you care if maybe I love horses?
I don't. A guy like you's got to love something. Oh, yeah, it was a sweet proposition. A jockey in search of a horse. There's something phony about the whole thing. I had the $200, but I didn't feel good. It was like a guy stealing a murder gun to help out in a scrap metal drive. Well, after the little guy left, I closed the office and started to hit the docks, but it didn't work out. You know, you can buy good whiskey these days, so you feel funny walking up to some guy on the pier and asking, "Have you seen a racehorse around here, mister?" By 9, I was sure the horse wasn't around, so I borrowed a car and drove out to the track. I found out where Sybil Thornton's horses were quartered and headed down that way. It was pretty dark, so when I bumped into her, all I got was a vague outline. She had a good-looking vague outline.
Oh, I'm very sorry.
Yeah, I'm full of regrets, too. Shall we try it again?
But you're a little mixed up in your animals. They keep horses here.
You don't seem to mind.
No, you lean nicely, but you'd probably feel safer with a platform.
Yeah. Well, we try this again when I've had 3 good meals. That's a horse.
Yes, I know. In fact, I own her.
I see. That'd make you Sybil Thornton.
Yes, what would it make you?
A guy named Pat Novak looking for your horse. I was hired in the waterfront to find her.
Why, they grow big on the waterfront. She must get a lot of sun. By the way, is Fleet Lady missing?
Your jockey says she is. That's why I'm snooping around.
Didn't know he had any friends.
She's got a checkbook. How about Fleet Lady? Is she tucked in bed?
Yes.
Well, let's take a look, huh?
Find it very dull, Mr. Novak.
Yeah, that's what they said to Anthony. Let's see the horse.
Suit yourself. She's down this way.
Okay.
I'm doing this out of the bigness of my heart. I think you're wasting my generosity, Mr. Novak.
I don't use it all this trip.
It's from the stable. Come on. Down about here. Fleet Lady's stall. Here. There's a flashlight on the wall.
All right. Do horses die broke, too? Who is it? Fleet Lady?
Yes, are you satisfied?
No, I'm going to ring up headquarters.
You crazy.
Then I'm going to call Jackie Gregg and tell him his hunch paid off.
I wouldn't do that, Mr. Novak.
Stop kidding me, sweetheart. She didn't get killed in the fight with another horse. Gregg figured somebody was telling the machine. That's why Fleet Lady's dead. That's why I'm going to call headquarters.
Suit yourself, but remember what happened to Fleet Lady.
Are you getting tough, Angel?
No. You just wouldn't look good with a saddle, Mr. Novak.
Well, I watched her as she turned and walked out of there. It was the kind of a walk that makes you flip the calendar and find out how far away spring is. I looked around a while, but it didn't do any good. The place was full of doors, so whoever killed Fleet Lady got out easy, like a rumor at a church picnic. I closed the door and went down the line to call headquarters. As I stood in there talking, I saw Sybil Thornton drive away. It was a long convertible with red asbestos seat covers. After I called headquarters, I went back and waited near the stable. About a half hour later, a police car pulled up, and when I saw who got out, I began to get unhappy like a three-legged man in a ballet school. It was Hellman from Homicide, and he had a squad with him.
All right, I'll talk to him. Hello, Novak. Where's your trainer?
Your boys get paid to laugh at you, Hellman. I don't.
Yeah, where's the horse?
What are you doing on the case?
I came for the ride. You mind, Novak?
No, I just wondered if they wised up downtown.
Huh?
Because you could find a dead horse, Hellman. If they staked it out in the middle of Market Street, you'd find it before long.
I'll try this time. Where is it?
Stall 18 over there.
Yeah. Keep an eye on them, boys. I'll be back in a minute. In here, Novak?
Yeah, the one with the teeth like yours.
You better shut up, Novak.
Don't get jumpy. You haven't seen the horse.
Just shut up, huh?
It wasn't going to be much of a conversation anyway.
What color horse was that, Novak?
What do you mean? Take a look at it.
Yeah, I did. I just took a look. It's a smart horse, Novak.
What?
That's right. That dead horse in there is wearing a double-breasted suit.
Hellman got the message straight. I walked in and took a look. Jackie Gregg was lying there on the floor as dead as last year's love. The sickness didn't show until we rolled him over on his stomach. Somebody had gone duck hunting in the middle of his back. I began to feel a little sick myself, and I was ready to send out for the same gun when Hellman started to talk.
You forgot to mention the guy when you phoned headquarters.
He wasn't there. I was in here before, and the guy wasn't around.
What was he doing under the horse?
I don't know. Hellman maybe crawled out of a crack. I don't know. There were two shots. I came in and found the horse.
Yeah?
Check the horse.
You're trying to tell me the horse shot back? Who is he?
A guy by the name of Jackie Gregg. He gave me $200 to find a missing horse.
Yeah?
A horse called Fleet Lady running into Mars Handicap. This is the end of the line.
How do you know it's the same one?
I don't. Maybe you got to be a horse to tell. Why don't you ask one of your boys? Yeah, your boy's real tough. Call him off, Hellman.
He's nasty. We all hate him, Novak.
It's all right. I'll put it on your bill, Hellman.
That's good. You can write it up at headquarters.
Hellman, you ought to rent an idiot. The heavy thinking's too much for you.
I can piece this together. We come out here and find a dead man with you kicking up dust 40 feet away.
Look, Hellman, I didn't kill the guy and call up headquarters. I know they're bad in Homicide, but I'm not that big-hearted.
We got a spare hook for you, Novak. That's where you stay until somebody gets you off.
Well, you can start out with Sybil Thornton.
Another horse?
She's got the speed for it. Look her up. She owns Fleet Lady, and she was dashing around in the dark here playing easy to get.
I'll look her up.
You better leave the boys behind, after all. She's only a woman. When you see her, ask her about that van down on the waterfront and what she was doing before I made that phone call.
I'll tag all the bases. Don't worry, Junior. And if things fit together, you'll both be in the jug. I'll see you later. I got work to do.
Yeah, it's getting late. You better put the boys back in the cage. I began to worry after Hellman left. There was no murder gun, and he didn't have too much to go on, but there was no one else wanted my job. Oh, I knew the girl was going to have an alibi, and I was the last guy that Jackie Gregg had seen. I had about as much chance as a fat girl at a Princeton prom. Hellman didn't like me, and he was a smart cop with a disposition like a ton of rhubarb. Well, I had to start right from scratch. I felt like Adam the first morning he woke up. So I looked up a guy named Jocko Madigan, an ex-doctor and a boozer who will give you a lift if you show him where the stirrups are. Well, he's a good guy, but he thinks all food makes a gurgle. I hit all the bars and finally found him up at Maggie Nielsen's apartment. She's a good-looking voice that lives up on the hill, and Jocko was working his way into her liquor supply.
Hello, Patsy. You're just in time to join me for my first drink of the evening, or one of my first, at least.
Yeah, I see.
Maggie's not here, but I found her whiskey. It was in plain sight, locked in the closet under some newspapers.
All right, Jocko, when are you going to sober up?
Oh, I plan to do it briefly on April 1st, when the rest of the world plays the fool also.
Look, I'm in trouble, Jocko. You got to help me.
Good. I've a special bottle I use to forget your troubles.
Now, look, stop caressing that jug and listen to me. I'm in a jam.
Patsy. See, there's nothing in nature so sad as a half-empty bottle. It's like a broken vow or an unfulfilled promise in the skies. A falling star, almost.
All right, Jocko.
A falling star, and you shrug it off, never realizing that a whole world has ended at that moment.
Yeah.
100 million dreams, maybe, and you watch it fall and make an asinine wish. That's all the good it does a star to fall. It gives some kid a chance to wish for a bicycle.
You all finished now, Jocko?
Yes. What kind of trouble? Anything I could aggravate?
I'm mixed up out at the track. A guy by the name of Jackie Gregg is dead, and I don't look good.
Oh. Hellman?
Yeah. The guy's a jockey, and he hired me to find a horse named Fleet Lady.
Did you?
The horse and the jockey ran a dead heat, but there's Something funny about the whole deal.
Did you talk to the jockey?
No, not enough.
Oh, Patsy, you've got to break yourself of the habit of waiting until people are dead before you think of a question.
Jocko, I want you to hit all the horse rooms. Find out what you can about the sixth race tomorrow. It's the Bonanza Handicap. Now hurry up, will you?
Well, if it's the sixth race, why can't we wait a while?
Start now. Get everything you can and call me. I'll leave a message at your place.
Where are you going?
I don't know. Maybe up to see the girl.
Oh, Patsy, you're going to be waving at the hangman's wife when they spring the trap door.
I gotta see her. She owns Fleet Lady.
Well, why don't I see her?
She's got a stake somewhere, and I got a lot of questions. What could you do up there?
Ah, yes. If it weren't an academic question, I'd argue the point.
Oh, it looked like a bum deal right from the start.
Patsy, you have the instinct for recognizing trouble, but not the intelligence to duck it.
Save your breath, will you?
You're like a man walking under a scaffold on a building. You realize it may crash down and kill you, but instead of hugging the building where you can't get hurt, like every other dope, you scurry for the edge of the sidewalk where you're bound to get hit if it falls.
Jocko, will you get out to those horse parlors? I need facts, not fables. Now, give me a hand.
All right. Give my love to Fleet Lady.
Her name's Sybil Thornton.
I'll bet I'm not far wrong. Good night, lover.
After I left Jocko, I went to the Chronicle Morgan. Looked up the NBC program director, Paul Stengel. We pulled out the clips on Sybil Thornton. They were nice and fat because she'd been to Reno four times and hadn't broke training for years. She'd been traded around more than a Red Sox pitcher. The clipping said she was 32. Well, there were a lot of pictures. And from her eyes, you got the idea she was around 35. But there were arguments the other way, too. Well, there weren't any stories on her for the last few months, just a few items from the columns. They all said the same thing. She was hitting the night spots with a gambler named Rudy Hauser. There were pictures of him, too. Now, he would look good in a cave with heavy curtains. I asked Paul. He said Hauser had a gambling place out on Geary, so I took a cab out there. For $10, the guy at the door said Sybil Thornton had left the place an hour ago. That made me feel good. When Hauser opened the door to his office, I lost the glow.
Yeah? What's with you?
I got a problem.
You got the wrong door.
Well, you can't get any tougher, so I'm coming in.
Yeah, suit yourself. I never throw anybody out until I'm sure they've lost all their money. What's on your mind?
A horse named Fleet Lady. She disappeared at 7 o'clock tonight.
Yeah, you check under the rug, I'll try the cabin.
She got back just in time to greet somebody's gunsel.
If I say no, will you go out and lose your money like a good boy?
Fleet Lady was owned by a gal named Sybil Thornton. The columns say you're number 5 on her list.
Well, they never lie. The whiskey's too good.
Also, a little bird says she was in your office an hour ago.
That's right. She said your name's Novak.
Yeah.
Next time you got a bombshell, give it a test run.
With Fleet Lady dead, your money's going to look real good in the six tomorrow.
Well, makes you think the gal would throw a race.
For the same reason she goes out with you?
Huh?
When a gal takes a Great Dane like you out in public, it generally means the guy's a few bucks ahead of her.
You want to fight the team now, Novak? Mm-hmm. And just remember, sometimes you can't be right in the gentleman, too.
Yeah. I hope that's the way you feel when they pick you up for Jackie Gregg's murder.
Huh?
Oh, you do a real nice double take, mister. The jockey checked out with a horse.
I didn't know that, Novak.
Yeah, with no brains, you built this gambling club.
I didn't know he was dead. If I told you that, Novak, I'd have meant it. He's all right for a little punk. I'm sorry he's dead.
So's he. I'll see you later, Hauser. I gotta nose around and find out where you were tonight.
Yeah. You seem all right, Novak. So I'll tell you. If you got any dough left when you leave my table, it's better on a horse named Fleet Lady in the sixth race tomorrow.
Do you always bet on a dead horse?
You got the tip? Use it or bury it, but don't loan it out.
Oh, the case was a regular grab bag when I walked out of Hauser's office. I began to tick off the things that didn't add up. First on the list was that van down on the waterfront. If it was Fleet Lady, who got shot in the stable? If it was the ringer, that meant Fleet Lady would run tomorrow. Oh, I couldn't figure out why Hauser was so sure she'd win. An idea kept racing around in the back of my mind like an ant in a cookie factory. Jackie Gregg lied about that van down on the waterfront, but why? Not to bail me out of the poorhouse with $200. Oh, I got part of the answer when I stopped with the pay telephone and called Hellman. This Novak. I got some news.
You have to put it on the back page.
What do you got?
Your friend Jackie Great had some love life.
Well, there's a chance for you, Hellman. Who's the girl? Sybil Thornton?
Yeah, we found a picture in his wallet. The gooey kind.
I'll bet you stole it for long train rides. What time did he die?
The right fit for you. Between 9 and 10 o'clock. 2 shots from a .32 caliber pistol.
How about the horse?
45 caliber.
Two people. It's getting involved.
Maybe, maybe not. You got two hands, Novak.
Look up a guy named Rudy Hauser. He's got a joint out on Geary Street.
I got enough friends. You look him up.
I did. He's still talking about Fleet Lady and tomorrow's race.
All right, maybe he's sentimental. Look, Novak, I'll pick out my own work. I don't need free help from you. Jackie Gregg paid $200 and look what he got.
That suits yourself, but Rudy Hauser and that gal are close friends.
Yeah?
Like two-part harmony in a telephone booth. Get off the dime, Hellman. Hauser's got that gal in his hip pocket. She owns Fleet Lady and he's betting her to win.
You're trying hard, Novak.
It's got to be a slow field to lose to a dead horse. Wake up, Hellman. You couldn't smell a rat in a basement full of cheese.
I did all right in your apartment.
Huh?
That .32 caliber pistol, we found it in your place. See you later.
About that. Hellman's smart enough to know a phony plant. I began to think about that .32 caliber pistol. It's a woman's weapon. Well, that doesn't prove anything. So's a bread knife if she's in a bad mood. Must have been about midnight when I got to Sybil Thornton's place. She was wearing black lounging pajamas tied tight around a slim waist. She looked like a wasp with a nice sting. She had company.
Come in, Mr. Novak.
Yeah.
Mr. Novak, this is Ronnie Stark.
Hello, Novak.
Well,
he's not very friendly, Sybil.
He's just parting because they're going to arrest him for Jackie's murder.
How do you like Hellman?
You've known him longer.
Yeah. Somebody left the murder gun up at my place. Where you been all night?
Please, Mr. Novak, you're embarrassing Ronnie.
That's right. I'm blushing, and it's not the whiskey, Novak.
I see.
You must stay longer, Ronnie.
She's persuasive, huh, Novak? See you tomorrow.
You won't forget, Ronnie.
No, I won't forget. I'm betting on you, Novak.
What won't he forget?
Mr. Novak, I hope nobody ever asks you that question.
You don't want to talk about putting that gun in my apartment?
No.
Let's talk about Rudy Hauser, then.
Hmm?
Your meat grinder friend. We just had a good talk, and he opened up a new road.
What'd you tell him?
Don't break a spring. He's all right.
Will you do me a favor, Patsy?
Like not talking to Hauser anymore? Huh?
That's right. Won't do you any good, Patsy. It'll do me a lot of good.
How's he going to know which horse got killed? I'll bet you lied to him, Angel.
It's my apple cart, Patsy. Leave it alone.
Sure. But play your hand right, maybe. Because I'm going to watch your cards. And if you got one that says Jackie Gregg, I'm going to call you the hard way.
Patsy, you nice beast. I really think you would. Sit down.
Yeah.
A drink?
No.
Do you good?
Not right now.
Well... You've read the book.
Just a couple of chapters.
I bet they're the right ones.
You better watch out, baby. I may be a long shot.
Well, you care as long as I bet.
I don't.
That's good. I didn't think you'd mind.
Aren't you beginning to crowd the beachhead?
Don't be a sissy, Patsy. You can't live forever.
All right, Angel. It's time to wire the folks.
Mr. Novak, just wait until you know me better.
That's for me. I left the number.
It's your fault, then.
Yeah.
Hello, Patsy.
What'd you find out, Jocko?
Not much. Nobody seems to care about the sixth race.
I care about it.
Well, that's because you killed one of the jockeys. The rest of the people have a more casual interest.
How do the odds run?
No heavy favorites. Vinair and Sleepy Time Gal figure to be the best at around 5-1.
What about Fleet Lady?
Down the line somewhere. I talked to one fellow... He says she's a dog and couldn't beat a paralytic goose over 100 yards.
Yeah, what else?
Well, that's all.
What do you mean, that's all? Start digging, Jocko. We're not getting any place.
Not even at your end?
Huh?
Well, I counted on you to do better than that. Good night, lover.
On the way home, I bought the morning papers. There was no story on Jackie Gregg, no details, and most of the story was a statement by Hellman on Hellman. There was no mention of Fleet Lady, and at 1 o'clock in the morning, there was nothing I could do but roll into bed. I woke up about 9, called Jocko. It was like sending a message out to the Farallones by Indian Runner. He just muttered and said he'd meet me out at the track. Well, I had to have some more dope, so I called Ira Snow. He calls the races and bets on them. The way he does it, a horse is a real beast of burden. He was playing elf when I got him on the wire.
Yeah?
Ira, this is Novak. What do you know about the Bonanza Handicap?
It's a horse race.
Now, you're funny. What about the field? Are the horses any good?
For hamburgers, maybe. Nothing else.
How about Fleet Lady?
Eastern track. Nobody knows.
course.
Would she be worth a heavy plunge?
Yeah, if you want to be a monk. What's this all about?
Ira, I'm in trouble. How about a fix? Could they run a ringer in on Fleet Lady?
Yeah, it's been done before, but it ain't easy.
That's what I figured. How's Rudy Hauser on horses?
He ain't. He got burned a long time ago. He never bets.
Well, I think you're wrong.
Look, Novak, I know every guy in town that's got the itch. Rudy Hauser, no.
You know a guy named Ronnie Stark?
Sure, he runs a book. Why?
Nothing. May see you at the track. I'm going to make a bet.
Yeah, I'll tell the horses.
Well, that left me in a hole. If Ira was right, Rudy Hauser on Fleet Lady didn't make a bit of sense. I got out to the track about 2:30. Jocko was there, and Hellman was wandering around up in the grandstand where they couldn't push him into a starting gate. Sybil Thornton waved from her box as I walked by to get a better shot at the starting line for the sixth. They were almost at the post when Jocko came back from the betting window.
Well, Patsy, I bet $2 on a horse called Scotch Victory. It seemed like a good omen.
Yeah.
I saw your friend Rudy Hauser at the window.
Huh?
He was pouring money down on the favorites to win.
Well, that's why the odds are going down on Vin Air and Sleepy Time Gal. Look at that board, will you?
Yeah, Fleet Lady's gone all the way up to 12 to 1.
Yeah, from 8 to 1. All the way up.
Maybe the word got around she's dead.
No, that's the funny part. She's down there. See, number 3 on the rail. Not a peep out of anybody.
Sarah Hot Mother is going to the front by one length. Sleepy Time Gal by a head. Fleet Lady between horses is running third by one length. On the outside, it's Vin Air and Old Soldier. Going into the clubhouse turn, it's Hot Weather by two lengths. Sleepy Time Gal by a half length. Fleet Lady is moving up on the outside. It's Vin Air fourth by one length. And Old Soldier. Down the back stretch, it's Hot Weather by two lengths. Fleet Lady, moving up on the outside, is now second by one length.
She runs well for a ghost. Rudy Hauser'd better hurry up or he won't see much.
What?
He better hurry. He left the track 10 minutes ago.
Huh? Are you sure, Jocko?
Yes, I heard him tell someone he had to make a phone call just before the betting closed.
Well, Jocko, you're a sweetheart.
Oh, I like to think.
Come on, let's go to that stable.
The race isn't over.
It was over 5 minutes ago.
Well, how about my $2?
Come on, will you? There's only one person who won't try to fix a horse race. That's a horse. Well, I knew there was going to be trouble fast. The horses were just coming under the wire when I waved to Hellman and started for the stable. When we got there, Sybil Thornton was clearing out like a fire sale.
I'm in a hurry, Patsy, darling. Let me by.
No, you made a bad play, Angel. Stick around.
Let me by, Patsy.
You heard him, lady. Stick around.
Thanks, copper. I'll take charge.
That's a big gun, Hauser.
I got a big beef. You let me drop $100,000, Sybil.
It's your idea, Rudy.
Not this way. You let me drop $100,000 because you ran Fleet Lady.
The program said Fleet Lady, and that's who ran.
I brought those odds into line at the window. My other idiot looked bad on Fleet Lady. You didn't stay to watch her trail the field.
All right, I didn't stay. You lost your $100,000. You killed the ringer. You were a smart big shot who was going to sew up the race.
You ran Fleet Lady and cost me $100,000. All right, copper, move away from her. Over this way, Sybil.
No. Don't let him do it, Patsy.
I want to see how tough you are.
Come on, Sybil. Let's you and me move against the stall.
Watch out, Hauser.
You're backing into the horse. Grab the horse, Novak. He's going to trample him.
You grab him. It's your idea.
Is he dead?
Yeah. You should have learned the first time you can't beat the horses.
That's a bump joke, Novak.
I guess it is.
Now that we're all here, who do we book for Jackie Gregg's murder?
I'll answer that, friend.
Who's this guy?
It's one you missed, Hellman. Hello, Stark.
Hiya, Novak. Well, what are you waiting for, Sybil? Tell the man you killed Jackie Gregg.
Had enough trouble today, Ronnie.
Now, you got more coming. Well, you figured it out yet, Novak?
Hauser dumped his $80,000 on you.
That's right. It's a lot of spending money.
Wait a minute. Ronnie, I don't like this.
Oh, you get your half, baby. I'm going to write out an IOU. When they book you for murder and the vote's in, you can't use it.
Wouldn't do a thing like that, Ronnie.
A dead girl can't spend $40,000. She killed your guy, copper, and tried to palm it off on Novak. I was there, so I'll testify.
Ronnie, you're a no-good guy.
Oh, don't be silly. I love justice. A booker for murder, copper. I want to tear up that IOU.
Well, Hellman finally worked it out. It started out as a fixed race, and when they were all through, it was up to the horse. Rudy Hauser put the squeeze on Sybil for some dough. She offered to run a fast ringer in place of Fleet Lady, so Hauser could pick up a bag full. Rudy just wanted to make sure, so he sent one of his boys around to knock off Fleet Lady. Only the guy killed the ringer instead. Well, that was a break for Sybil. She made a deal with a bookie named Ronnie Stark to take all of Hauser's bets and guarantee him that Fleet Lady couldn't win because she wasn't that good a horse. It panned out that way. She let Hauser think Fleet Lady was dead. He spent the 20 grand at the window pushing up the odds on Fleet Lady and dumped another 80 on her to win. The moving van? Well, that was a phony story Greg used to get me to scare Sybil. He wanted in on the deal. He went back to the stable that night, got in a beef, and she killed him. She had him out in her car. When I went to make that phone call, she figured it was a good way to pass the buck. Well, Hellman asked only one question. Why would a nice, tame horse go crazy and trample a guy to death? Jocko had the answer. The horse that killed Hauser was a filly.
Broadcasting Company has just brought you the fourth of a new series, Pat Novak for Hire, starring Jack Webb. Pat Novak is produced and directed by William P. Rousseau. Jocko Madigan is played by Tudor Owen. Inspector Hellman is played by Raymond Burr. Music was composed and conducted by Basil Adlam. In our cast were Virginia Gregg, Tal Avery, Stacy Harris, Hugh Thomas, and Carlisle Bibbers. This program is being released to our servicemen and women overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. Be with us again next week when over most of these same ABC stations, we will bring you Pat Novak for Hire. This program came to you from Hollywood. Listening reminder. Tonight, don't miss Jane Wyman when she guest stars and explains how she created her unforgettable role as the deaf mute in Johnny Belinda. Hear Jane Wyman tonight on this ABC station. This is ABC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Hi, this is Frank Brzee, Little Beaver on Old Time Radio's Red Rider. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Pat Novak for Hire. That was Fleet Lady from March 6, 1949, originally over ABC West Coast and KGO. And did you listen to the end there? A couple little bloopers. Now, I'm not sure. There's one part of this that I am not totally sure of, or actually a couple of parts. The first one being the announcer saying, after Carlisle Bibbers, the name, he starts laughing a little bit. Probably because it was just such a silly name, Bibbers, you know, it just, and you know, one of those things, when something strikes you funny, even if you are on live radio, you start laughing.
I personally am offended because I'm a big fan of everything that Carlisle Bibbers has ever done.
Yes, Steve is president of the Carlisle Bibbers fan club.
In fact, that's the only thing I know Carlisle Bibbers ever did was this role in this.
But
this
you heard thing. The announcer snicker a little bit and somebody in the background giggling a little bit. And then he goes on to say, this is ABC, the National Broadcasting Company. And another couple of laughs. Now, I don't know exactly who this was. Our information says George Fenneman was the announcer. It didn't quite sound like George there. But other information I have from Jerry Handiga's radio log for Pat Novak for Hire says that it was Fred Foy. And maybe Fred had stepped in to do duty as announcer just for this one episode or something. I'm not sure. If anybody has further details on this, please let us know. We'd like to know for sure. And I'm wondering if this might have been a possible rehearsal show, too. what we heard was an actual rehearsal, and, you know.
Did it go off the air this way? I mean, out on the air this way?
I'm wondering about that, too. if anybody out there listening knows anything more about this particular incident, let us know, you know. It kind of reminds me of something Bob Hastings talked about in his interview that we have on the on our website here. Because you mentioned one of the birthdays recently. I don't know if it was this episode or the one before, Juano Hernandez.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Bob had a funny anecdote about him. He used to do a show with him called The Sea Hound, Adventures of the Sea Hound and Jerry, or something like that. Adventures of the Sea Hound, actually, was the name of the show. And there was a scene where, you know, the announcer comes on and he's introducing the thing. And just then, Juano Hernandez burps. Breaks up. It has to go out into the hall. He's got the first line. So the announcer or Bob has got to kind of fill in with, oh, God, well, I'm running through the jungle here and I'm, you know, trying to. And he's trying to fill in while this guy's out in the hall laughing his ass off because he just belched on the air, you know. Because I had asked Bob for humorous anecdotes, and that's the one he came up with. And that was kind of funny to me, actually.
That was the show that I announced because it was Juano Hernandez's birthday was July the
19th. Okay, all right.
So it was this one.
So that was the first time that Juano Hernandez ever burped. he was in his diaper and bibbers. No? Okay, thanks, Ringo. He fell asleep. He's in the bathroom or something. Anyway, folks, we have two more Jack Webb shows to bring you here in this tribute to Jack Webb on the Glowing Dial. But we're going to get to that in just a moment. We have two friends of ours standing by, Mr. Fred Foy. And Greg
That's
Parker.
Why it's so crowded in this room here. We have Ringo, that whole audience in the closet, and then we have these two guys standing
Tell
right
me here. About it. It's just awful. So anyway, they're standing by, and with that audio tennis match that we like to call the contact information clip, folks, we want to hear from you by snail mail, email, or telephone, and let us know if you've got a suggestion for a future theme for a show or a some request for our next All Request show, whatever it is, any comments you have about us or the show, we'd like to hear from you. So Fred and Greg, take it away, boys.
This is Fred Foy, here to tell you how you can get in touch with the Glowing Dial. Big John and Steve want to hear from you. They'd like your comments and suggestions and any requests you may have. You can contact them by any of the following means. Send email to
glowingdial@yahoo.com. That's GLOWINGDIAL. @yahoo.com.
Or by phone by calling
586-791-0677. That's 586-791-0677. Or call 248-733-9248. That's 248-733-9248.
Or send snail mail to the Glowing Dial,
1401 Key West Drive, Troy, Michigan, 48083-1055.
Write or call now. Big John and Steve are waiting to hear from you.
All right, thank you, Fred, and thank you, Greg. And there you have it, folks. Those are the methods to contact us, so please do. We'd like to hear from you.
Fred, was that you laughing?
We'll
be serious
to,
now.
When we contact him to recut this ad, the contact spot, we should ask him if that was actually him. Go to the source, I say, huh? How about that? Anyway, we have two more episodes of Jack Webb programs to bring you here, and we're going to get to all that and more right after this.
Hi, Big John and Steve here to tell you how you can help support the Glowing Dial.
You know, it takes a lot of time and effort to maintain the Glowing Dial page and produce new episodes of the show. It also takes something we usually don't have enough of, money.
The Glowing Dial page and show are non-profit entities, and all costs incurred come out of our pockets, and we could use a little help from you, our listeners.
There are several ways you can help support the Glowing Dial, and all these methods can be accessed on our main page at www.glowingdial.com.
One way to support us is to click on the Amazon.com Honor System box on our main page and make a donation. It can be as little or as much as you can afford. Every little bit helps.
Another way is to purchase items from the Glowing Dial online store through cafepress.com. There you will find an ever-increasing variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo.
You can also shop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Every time you order something from our bookstore, you are helping to support the Glowing Dial.
If you're a fan of Dick Orkin's radio work, then why not order the complete set of Chicken Man episodes on CD? Just scroll down our main page until you see those silly dancing chickens. Purchase of this set also helps support us here at the Glowing Dial.
So there you have it, folks. Four ways that you can help support us and ensure the continuation of the Glowing Dial page and show. We thank you in advance. And we're back. I'm Big John. That's Steve. And we're here with our next episode featuring Jack Webb as another detective. This one is Jeff Reagan, Investigator. The episode is called The Lawyer and the Lady from December 4th, 1948, originally over CBS West Coast. This is starring Jack Webb, Herb Butterfield, Larry Dobkin, Carol Matthews, no relation, Lou Krugman, Marvin Miller, Herb Vigran, and Mary Lansing. Bob Stevenson is announcing, and the show was sustained. So, Stephen.
That's another Herb Butterfield. He appeared with Herb Butterfield before. He likes.
Jack Webb had his company of people he liked working with, and a lot of them went over onto the TV shows that he did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Herb Vigran, I remember in Dragnet. So, yeah, he used him a lot. So.
Olan Soule was in a lot of these things. Yeah, he turned up in some Project UFOs
He likes certain people, and he uses them a lot.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Steve, you're going to tell us about Jeff Reagan, Investigator, out of that wonderful John Dunning book.
Oh, yes. It's full of facts. Wonderful book. Everybody who's interested in OTR should have one of those, you know.
Well, you know how you can get that, no?
Let your fingers do the walking.
Yeah, but you walk right over to glowingdial.com, click
That's
on
right.
bookstore, and there it is. And every time you order through our bookstore, we get a little bit of credit for that, and it helps to support us here at the Glowing Dial. So, Stephen, what does it say about Jeff Reagan, Investigator?
Okay, Jeff Reagan, Investigator is detective drama. And which is in the style of Jack Webb,
right.
mainly because he likes detective drama type shows. Jeff Reagan was a response to a groundswell of demand for Jack Webb's services in the wake of his hilarious hard-boiled performances in Pat Novak for Hire. Webb had built almost a cult following, and Reagan was the transition show away from Novak and into Dragnet. It was momentarily a step back. It lacked the originality and flavor of Novak, and it certainly lacked the humor. Webb played the role well into 1949, but by January he had confided to a Radio Life reporter that his next character might be called Joe Friday. A reorganization of Reagan titled The Lion's Eye followed Webb's inevitable departure.
Yep, and that was starring Frank Graham, I believe, took over the role at that point. So, yeah, Jeff Reagan, Investigator, was a little more straight-laced, not quite as corny with all the similes and metaphors as Pat Novak or Johnny Madero used. But it's still interesting and had a decent run. And I guess once that information has been brought forth by Mr. Steve, it's time that we bring forth the McGee Machine and tune this episode in.
Yes, he has to bring it forth. It's right there. It's just they can't see it because we're on radio.
Right.
Right. Right.
And your twiddling does you justice, sir.
Yes.
Steve Archiver Banneke, twiddler from way
practice back. Practice real long hard to learn how to do that.
I know you did. I know you did. And it shows. It really does. And the radio is in love with you. But anyway, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember Jeff Reagan, Investigator. This is The Lawyer and the Lady from December 4th, 1948, originally over CBS West Coast.
Reagan. I get 10 a day in expenses from a detective bureau run by a guy named Anthony J. Lyon. They call me the Lion's Eye.
Jack Webb is Jeff Reagan, Investigator, as CBS offers you hard-boiled action and mystery and thrilling adventure in tonight's story of The Lawyer and the Lady.
The car Cosmopolitan buildings on 7th Street near Olive, downtown L.A. International Detective Bureau is up on the third floor, suite 308. Right across from an elevator that hasn't been inspected since 29, when the guy who built the place took a vacation up at Folsom. I always use the stairs. Well, the plaster's bad, but the rent's cheap, and the lion says his office is just the kind of place that invites business. He's got a leather chair there, about the shape of a fallen biscuit, that's for him to relax on. And right next to a desk with some blank checks and an inkwell, there's a hard, straight chair, that's for the client. The lion got mad when our last customer asked if the chair was wired. Well, when I walked in last Thursday night about 6 o'clock, he was staring at that empty chair. Wishful thinking.
Regan! Christmas is coming.
Well, that's news.
It's the time of year when everybody's nice to everybody else.
Somebody give you a calendar?
I got better than that. It's a check.
From who?
His name's Kramer. He's a big lawyer.
We need one again?
He's our new client. He wants to see you.
What about?
He'll tell you.
You tell me.
I want you to be nice to him. He's a big man. His office is in the Park Central building. Abercrombie, Kramer, and Schmidt.
A trio.
It's an important legal firm in this city.
Well, what's the job?
I told you he'd give you all of it.
Look, the last time I waited for a client to talk, he died.
Now, look here. The kind of dough he pays, you could do janitor work for him and not ask questions.
Well, you never learn.
This is a certified check. Came by special messenger. He's waiting for you now.
What else?
The message said he wanted all this done confidentially. No police. You understand?
You'd kidnap your own mother for cash.
You're not alive.
And then you'd starve to death charging yourself ransom.
I'm going to be patient with you, Regan.
Oh, this is another rotten deal.
These big legal outfits can't afford to be dishonest.
You've been making a living doing it.
Kramer's in legitimate practice. I checked him.
Oh, sure you
did. I pay your salary and I take things as I see them.
Well, you need stronger glasses. Well, I left him sitting there holding the check up to the light. He had both arms above his head. He reminded me of a two-armed slot machine. I walked the four blocks over to the Park Central building, and an elevator operator with a cardboard collar took me up to the seventh floor. Abercrombie, Kramer, and Schmidt had a flock of stables in the back with a fire escape. The names were hung out in silver, and I figured if they were ambulance chasers, they used a motorcycle escort. I opened the door and stepped into a green carpet that needed mowing. Then I heard a noise at the deep end where the trout stream should have been. She had hair the color of smoke. The rest of her spiraled up to match. But she looked unhappy, like a termite in a granite quarry. She glanced at her typewriter, and then up at me, the Remington One.
We've already ordered our Christmas cards. Get them in July.
Or maybe I'm not selling.
You should. You're the type.
Kramer in?
He might be. But he never sends cards. Doesn't believe in Christmas.
Well, he sent my office a check.
Did he? What office is that?
I'm Regan, International Detective Bureau.
Stick to greeting cards.
Kramer sent for me.
Oh? He wants protection, huh?
You tell me.
Maybe it's something else.
Well, let's find out.
In a minute. He's busy right now.
What's the matter with Abercrombie?
He's dead.
Schmidt?
Wishes he was. Palm Springs with a hangover.
Yeah, real nice bunch. How long you worked for him?
Too long. My jokes are newer.
Well, Benny's making a move. Maybe he'll hire you.
I don't like funny men. What do you do when you're not working?
All depends on who I'm with.
Thought maybe you were antisocial. That's Kramer's...
I was ahead of her trying the door, but it was locked from the inside. She fumbled around on the desk and finally brought out a key. Kramer was sitting at his desk holding onto the front of his shoulder. His face was white and he wasn't feeling too good.
Fire escape. He got through there. Emmy, call Dr. Sorensen. This wouldn't look good in the papers. No police.
That's a big order.
Well, that's a big hole in his shoulder. It was too late to start looking around the fire escape, and when Dr. Sorensen showed up, he called a private ambulance and had Kramer taken to a private hospital. The doc said he wouldn't be able to talk until morning, and, well, if they wanted it quiet, there was no sense getting homicide all excited. Emmy went to the hospital with him, and I hung around the office for a little while. Everything was locked up tight. The files, his desk, and the liquor cabinet. So I figured it was time to give the lion the nod. I doused the lights and went downstairs. Outside, the street was kind of vacant except for a steamroller with whiskers washing down the gutters. It dodged around a big green car parked by the curb, and then it swivel-hipped around my car, where a little guy in a trench coat was leaning in looking at my registration tag. When I tapped him on the shoulder, he looked confused, like he was trying to catch a cyclone in a paper bag.
Huh?
You looking for something?
Oh, no, no. No, just...
Looking.
Yeah, that's right. Looking.
Come on, blow your nose.
A little cold, that's all.
Tell me about it before your throat gets sore.
I told you, just looking.
The car belongs to the finance company in case you got extra keys.
No, Pilgrim. Never borrowed a buggy in my life.
You can't drive.
How'd you guess?
Come on, you, let's pour it out.
Sure. You the guy?
What guy?
Guy that says there. Regan.
I might be.
I want to make a mistake.
Deal, will you?
Somebody wants to see you.
Who?
Guy.
Well, I don't know him.
Yeah, guy says please.
Reads Emily Post.
That's right. Friend of mine. Weighs 285 pounds. He's across the street in the ice cream parlor. Last stool on the end.
Well, I'll tell you, somebody else is carrying my books home today.
Oh, he wouldn't care. Big man. Going to see him?
Can't he walk?
He says if you argue, mention the name Kramer. Now you going to see him?
How can I miss? He weighs 285 pounds. Oh, it didn't figure, but sometimes you look and nothing figures. Kramer had taken one in the shoulder, and before he'd been able to talk, the lights had gone out, and he wound up in a hospital. Well, somebody had an angle, and maybe it was the guy across the street. I found him sitting all alone, about 300 pounds of beard in a plaid coat. He was picking all the strawberries out of his ice cream. Hey, you sent for me?
Mm-hmm. Regan?
You got it.
Have something. Great banana split here. Four kinds of ice cream.
I'm on a diet.
Oh, I never worry about things like that. It's a mistake. You only live once. Know me?
You got a name?
Speck Jameson. You know me now?
You got a grudge with Kramer?
Yeah.
You shot at him from the fire escape.
I did? When?
Half hour ago.
Anybody see me?
No.
That's good. How'd I do?
He got it in the shoulder. He'll live.
Up to that point, it could have been me.
Well, it's going to make a good story for the police.
For anybody. I'm clean as a whistle. You sure you won't have something?
Now, look. I got a date, Fatso. Let's fan this out.
Oh, sure.
How about Kramer?
Oh, yeah. Where'd you say he was?
Hospital.
Oh, yeah. He hire you for protection?
Maybe.
Regan, you got a lot to learn about life.
No, just about living.
You catch on quick.
To what?
Now you take me, for instance.
Your complexion's not so good.
It'll improve. Besides, I don't like trouble, Regan.
Well, you'll have to get used to it.
It's just there's some things a man can't stand. Can't take lying down.
Name three.
No, I just want you to understand I know what I'm doing, that's all. And this is what I'm doing. All right, Regan. Back on your feet.
Yeah, they serve that ice cream in big dishes,
don't
they?
I'll give you a boost. Here's my hand.
Take off the knuckles.
Quiet, Regan. There's some more metal in my pocket.
I don't need a Geiger counter.
I said you were smart. Now get this. It's a clean sweep. You're staying out of it.
Suppose I stick around.
Then I'll unglue you.
I left him sitting there with his ice cream. Wouldn't have done any good to trade fists with him. But there was something in the way he talked about Kramer and the shooting that made it a Sunday puzzle. I found a phone booth and put in a call to the Lion.
Regan, where you been? You see Kramer? What'd he say?
Well, now, which one do you want first?
What about Kramer?
He was all shot up.
Target practice?
Some guy with a grudge.
If he plays like that, yell cop.
Look, they'll want to see you. No police, remember?
What are you talking about?
Another bum client.
Why do these things always happen to me?
Because your palm is faster than your brain.
Every case has it.
Look, this is a three-ring circus, and we haven't even got any peanuts.
Well, maybe I should have found out what he wanted.
Oh, you say that now.
Who's got the grudge?
a sweet tooth, calls himself Speck Jameson.
Speck, where's he fit in?
He wouldn't stand still to show me his tea leaves.
You talked to him?
We met.
When people start asking questions, we don't want to be stuck without any answers. You get out and run down some dope on this man, Speck.
What are you going to do?
Don't worry, I'll take her on my end.
Yeah, most people do. Well, this job had more ups and downs than the Berlin airlift. I turned the phone book over to some drunk with a beer breath, and I walked over a couple of blocks to the morgue. I mean, the one where they keep dead newspapers. I got a friend who works in the file room of the L.A. Times. After 15 years of it, he's got about as much adrenaline as an old magazine in the attic.
No. I never heard of a Speck Jameson. Probably a nickname, isn't it? You know, Speck, short for glasses.
Yeah, I caught the drift.
Thought I was going to say spectacles, didn't you?
Hey, look, let's try this for size.
Yeah.
Big, fat guy, but always hungry.
Mention any friend?
Kramer, and he wasn't a friend.
Speck Adams in last Thursday's paper.
What'd he do?
Executed the same day in Sing Sing.
Speck Jameson.
Released from Quentin day before yesterday.
Let me see.
That's all it says. Served full 10-year sentence, continuous on 4 counts.
Somebody threw a book at him.
Yeah, maybe. Tell you in a minute.
Try December 38.
This case would have come up in November. Here we are. You take these.
Yeah.
Hey, look at the funny skirts. Short, weren't they? Hey, here's one. War impossible, says
look,
Senator.
Look, let's stick to the subject.
November 17th, Jameson appeal denied.
Read it, Vinny.
A lot of stuff. He was in the rackets.
Go on.
Judge said unusual completeness of prosecution's case made retrial impossible.
Mm-hmm.
Continuous sentence upheld.
Who was the judge?
O'Govern. He's dead. Here's what you want. Special Prosecutor Joseph W. Kramer.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Joseph W. Kramer was brilliantly
Hello?
Relentless work for the forces of good in Los Angeles.
It's for you.
Okay, thanks. Yeah?
Mr. Regan?
Yeah.
This is Emmy, Mr. Kramer's secretary. Are you always this hard to find?
Well, that depends on where you look.
Mr. Kramer wants to see you.
You talking now?
He's feeling much better. The doctor said it was just a flesh wound.
What kind?
38.
All right. Where's the hospital?
It's a little place on Hawthorne. Mrs. Kramer will show you.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't mind going by the Biltmore and picking her up.
I haven't got my car.
Use Mr. Kramer's. It's in the garage there.
Is she expecting me?
I phoned.
15 minutes.
Good. He wants to thank you for what you did.
Well, what did I do?
Kept the police out of it.
Well, it's his show, but it may close.
What do you mean?
I ran into Speck Jameson.
Oh?
Now, you still want the police out of it?
I don't know. Mr. Kramer will tell you when he sees you.
Mm-hmm. You sound like you're changing jobs. So I went over to the garage, and I picked up his car, and then I drove to the hotel entrance. While I was arguing with a cab driver, Mrs. Kramer walked out. 45, a little tired around the eyes. She was wearing a white sheet, double bed size, under a mink coat that must have set somebody back $10,000. She didn't look like a wife that Kramer would have.
I hope this isn't inconveniencing you.
No, it's not.
Are you sure my husband's all right?
He's talking, according to Emmy.
Emmy? She's there with him.
She's his secretary.
Funny, isn't it? I'm his wife, yet she spends more time with him than I do.
Well, that's business.
Even now. When he's been hurt, she's there first.
She was there when it happened.
Of course. I guess I... Oh, never mind. You're a detective, aren't you?
Yeah, that's right.
Mr. Kramer hired you to protect him from that Jameson.
I never found out. Maybe.
I've been so worried about him. At the trial, Jameson said he'd kill him if it was the last thing he ever did. You know, I always thought it was taking an awful... Awful...
Hey, take it easy, lady.
You know the story.
Emmy?
She's young, pretty. I have to spend my time at bridge parties.
Does it help?
No.
How long have you been married to him?
Next month, 18 years. I don't look the same way anymore.
Neither does he.
It's funny what life does to you, isn't it? I was his secretary once. That's how I met him.
Look, how far to the hospital?
It's only a few more blocks. You go straight
Hang on. What do you know that drives a big green Nash?
know him.
Well, he knows us. Been following us since we left the hotel.
What do you say?
Is he still with us?
Yes. I can't understand a thing like this happening. Why would anybody want to follow us?
Maybe it's a friend of your husband's.
Jameson?
He tried once tonight. Maybe it'd be better to get you.
I'm scared.
All right, come on. Come on, get out, get out.
Mr. Regan!
The green Nash had been tailing me. I shook it on the last corner. There are lots of them, but it might have been the same one that was parked by my car downtown earlier. Oh, it made no sense, but I wasn't taking any chances. Only before I could get the door open, the Nash came sliding around the other side of the block. I shoved Mrs. Kramer into the floorboards and slid under the wheel. A lot of glass got broken fast. By the time I could separate my teeth from the clutch pedal, the car had gone. I shook Mrs. Kramer, but she didn't shake. She was dead.
You are listening to the story of the lawyer and the lady, tonight's adventure with Jeff Regan, investigator. Listen, this is good news. Good news for you if you're between the ages of 20 and 26 and a half, married or single, a high school graduate, and want to fly for the United States Air Force. Yes, the Air Force Aviation Cadet Program is offering you the opportunity to become a pilot officer in the mightiest Air Force in history. You can be one of the Air Force's men of renown. And there's more offered than the pride you feel in being a member of America's flying team. For after your 52 weeks of training, you'll graduate as a second lieutenant in the Air Force with an income of more than $300 per month. Remember, the Air Force offers you what it offered General Jimmy Doolittle, General Carl Spatz, and General Hoyt Vandenberg. Now, at 42, the Air Force Chief of Staff. Call at your local Army and Air Force recruiting station tomorrow. Apply to become an aviation cadet. And now, back to the story of the lawyer and the lady and Jeff Regan, investigator.
Well, it all made sense, like a Ubangi with a piccolo. It started when the Lion sent me over to see a lawyer named Kramer. I got there just in time to meet Emmy, his receptionist, and find Kramer with a bullet in his shoulder. The hospital took over and I left. That's when I ran into Spec Jameson, an ex-con who Kramer put away some 10 years ago. He turned out to have a lot of stomach and a big hate for the lawyer. And then I got a call from Emmy to pick up Mrs. Kramer. I did, and the shots began, and she ended up a candidate for the city morgue. Well, I called homicide, and I sent out some boys to clean up. I gave them what I knew, and I moved on out to see Kramer. The Angels of Mercy Hospital turned out to be a private place off Hawthorne. Two stories of cement set down in the middle of a clover field. Figured that they only held a thermometer to patients that could make a big noise with a cash register. Kramer showed in an upstairs room next to a fire escape. He was climbing into an overcoat. When he saw me, he looked unhappy, like a pointer with a broken tail.
Well, Regan, I'm glad you came to see me.
Tell me that later.
What do you mean?
How's the shoulder?
Oh, a little annoying, but it's all right.
Well, that figures.
Why?
It was a neat shot, just enough to raise a little fever.
What are you driving at?
Give it a chance. It'll sink in.
Come on, let's get out of here.
All right.
Picked up my wife downtown?
Yeah.
Good, good. She worries a lot. You know, tell you what, Regan, I'll send a check around in the morning for another 100. That all right?
Make it 1,000.
What's that for?
Insurance against guys like you.
Never mind that, Regan.
Why didn't you tell the Lion what you wanted in the first place?
I didn't know.
I got another story.
Well, you're wrong.
You knew Spec Jameson was out.
No reason I should tell you that.
I'm rehearsing a witness, that's all.
What?
Yeah, now let's hear what you did to him.
Nothing, not a thing. He can tell you that.
In 38, you got the book thrown at him.
He was a public enemy.
So's Smog.
Regan, a man in my position...
Maybe that's it. Maybe you're the kind of shyster that build a rap on convictions.
I'll grant you it helped. That's all you want.
So he hated you.
He made threats.
What cooled him off?
$10,000.
When?
After I discovered he meant business. I sent someone with the money.
Figured Jameson'd forget everything for cash.
Men of his stripe always will.
You made a mistake.
Everybody does sometimes. I guess Jameson is still using his gun.
Yeah.
But my shoulder will mend.
Your wife won't.
What do you mean?
She's dead.
No.
Homicide will tell you different.
I'd better go down to see them.
Yeah.
That bullet was meant for me.
Yeah, like you said, everybody makes mistakes. Well, we climbed in the taxi and headed for headquarters. Kramer looked confused. He mumbled a few words about what a good cook his wife had been, how he'd always tried to protect her from the stuff that he'd done to make a success. He was the kind of guy that always figured it was better to make a deal than face facts. Now he had to face a backfire. Well, there were a couple of newspaper photographers in front of the place. Kramer's shoulders dropped a couple of notches, then he headed for inside. I started in behind him, but an arm stopped me.
Regan, come here.
What are you doing out of bed?
Shut up. Get back in the taxi.
Look out, that meter will bite you.
I'm not paying the fare. Downtown, driver.
Okay, Mac.
You know the cops are going to love you for this.
They can hear your side of it later.
Sure, and you'll stand behind me.
Now, Regan, I'll tell you how I figure this. She gets killed. It was a mistake.
Oh, now, that takes a big brain.
Kramer's got enemies. Said Emma enemy, did in the wife Regan to get Kramer.
That's the last chapter.
And we write the next one. Turn in said enemy, and we'll pick us up a nice fat reward.
Homicide started with Jameson already.
They're going to be surprised.
What do you mean?
He didn't do it.
How do you know?
I look into things. That's how I know.
Well, all right, big shot. Open it up.
It goes this way. 15 minutes after I talk to you, I put a call into the cops.
Saying what?
That I don't like my operator being threatened by ex-cons. What happens?
You tell me.
The police themselves take Jameson out of circulation. He was locked up before Mrs. Kramer got fired. He's sitting in the Hollywood Station House right now with a smile on his face.
Talking?
No. Eating ice cream.
Well, now it really made sense, like a mermaid on a bicycle. If Jameson didn't throw the lead, I had to find out who did. The taxi dropped me off downtown across from the Park Central building, and I started up the elevator to Kramer's office. It figured to be the time to get a look inside that locked desk. When I opened the door marked Abercrombie, Kramer, and Schmidt, the place was dark. I moved into Kramer's office and started a little work on the desk. It took me about 10 minutes to get inside. Nothing showed in the first two drawers, but in the third, I picked up a box of Panatellas and I looked under it. That's where I found a .38 with one bullet missing. Well, ballistics could do something about it, so I crammed it in my overcoat pocket and I started outside. That's when the door opened and the little guy with a runny nose walked in. He was wearing a suit the color of an avocado and his face looked like a fried banana.
It's a nice rug, huh?
You from the cleaners?
I make my own spots. Sit down, Regan. We're gonna talk.
I'll take it standing.
We prefer you sitting.
It's your gun.
More natural that way.
You got a name, Buster?
They call me the Dove.
The Bird.
No cracks. Just a Dove.
Peace mission?
It is. Resting.
All right, what is it this time?
Where's Kramer?
China.
Regan, you're an unlucky contestant.
If you don't like my answers, try somebody else.
That's what I'm doing, correcting mistakes.
Like shooting the wrong guy.
Like leaving a witness. I had to get rid of my Nash on account of you.
You killed her, now you're waiting for her husband.
Of course I killed her, but don't try to change the subject. It's you I'm talking about now.
Well, I don't like the spotlight.
You should have stuck to your nose in here, Regan. It'll bleed.
Well, let's start with yours. I dove for him and the gun went off, only it wasn't pointed at me. Kramer was standing in the doorway pulling a trigger like a kid at a bubblegum machine. I figured the floor was safer, so I flattened out. The Dove tried the same, only he hit the wastebasket.
Did I get him?
Well, he looks as dead as he'll ever be.
A cheap murdering...
Look, let me hold the gun, huh, Kramer?
Yes. Oh, Regan, there's a bottle in the cabinet there.
Sure. There you are.
Thank you.
Now, what are you going to do now?
I don't know. Call the police, I guess.
I thought you were with them.
I came down in their car to get some of my files.
On the old Jameson case?
Yes.
You want to tell me?
Oh, it's about as you know. He was a small-time grifter. I gave myself a big name by prosecuting him, built my business and the reputation it gave me.
You told the police why he hates you?
Oh, yes. I intend to stand trial for killing this man.
You're growing up, Kramer.
Who was he, anyway?
The Dove.
No driver's license. Oh, yes, here it is. Dove Duval. Regan, look at this.
It's a lot of money.
It's $10,000. Same amount of money I sent to Jameson to stay away from me. Looks like the chickens came home to roost, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does.
Well, police are waiting. I better go and tell them about this.
Go on.
You coming?
No, I'll meet you there, Kramer. I got a late date. I gave the boys downstairs the high sign, then I moved out of there fast. I found Emmy's place just off Normandy. It was a brand new duplex with a gilt-edged driveway and stocks and bonds for awnings. For a business girl, she really did all right. I was a couple of hours overdue, but the girl with the smoky hair knew how to wait. There was a candle burning in her window and two more in her eyes. It took me a little time.
But now you're here.
Uh-huh.
Well, aren't you going to do something about it?
Yeah. Talk.
Mr. Regan, what's the matter with you?
I've been working hard.
Oh, is that all?
Now, listen, lady. This is just too pat, too neat. The ends tied together like Siamese twins.
I'm alone.
Yeah, but you don't want to be. Your boss just rubbed out a killer named Dove.
What?
It was self-defense. I'm a witness, and he'll be out of it inside a week.
Well, then what are we bothering about?
A guy named Jameson. Nobody will believe him.
Why should they?
Because they didn't hire the Dove.
Who did?
You.
Mr. Regan.
All right, maybe it was your boss. He primed me with a story about giving Jameson 10 G's. Only one ever saw that doe was the Dove.
Well?
That was his price for killing Mrs. Kramer.
You're out in left field, Mr. Regan. I was working.
You were keeping me outside till Kramer could throw a small bullet into his shoulder.
Why would he do that?
To point up that Jameson was still after him.
But he was.
I figured different. And homicide's gonna like my way.
I don't even know what you're talking about.
Well, this gun has a different version.
Where'd you get it?
Kramer's bottom drawer. And the caliber is going to fit the hole in your boss's shoulder.
Well, that's it. You've got it all now.
Yeah. You know, you got a real nice hair.
Yeah?
That San Quentin water's going to ruin it. Well, the whole thing came apart like a paper hat in a shower bath. Seems that when Jameson got out of prison and threatened Kramer, the lawyer and his secretary figured that it was a good time to get rid of the wife. I suppose she interfered with their skiing or something. Anyway, they hired the Dove to do the job and got rid of him just so he couldn't ever come to bat for the fall guy, Jameson. Yeah, they had a perfect frame fixed for him, and I was picked to decorate the edges, only it didn't work. Everybody was positive about this one. Kramer knew he was going to win. Emmy knew she was in for a big cut. And the lion knew he was going to collect a fat fee. They should have all figured it. This is the year for upsets.
Jack Webb is featured as Jeff Regan with Herb Butterfield as Anthony J. Lyon. It's CBS at the same time next week for more hard-boiled action and mystery with Jeff Regan, Investigator. Written by Jackson Gillis and D. Jack Newman. Produced by Sterling Tracy. Featured in tonight's story were Carol Matthews, Marvin Miller, Lou Krugman, Herb Vigran, Mary Lansing, and Larry Dudkin. Original music for this program is by Milton Charles. This is Bob Stevenson speaking. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Hello there. This is CBS Mystery Theater's Corrine Orff. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Jeff Regan Investigator. That was The Lawyer and the Lady from December 4th, 1948, originally over CBS West Coast. And we have one more show featuring Jack Webb to bring you here in this edition of The Glowing Dial. And we're going to get to all of that and more right after this important message. Hi, this is Big John.
And Steve.
And we're here to tell you all about the Glowing Dial online store.
That's right, John. The Glowing Dial online store is your one-stop shop for all things Glowing Dial.
You're sure to be fashionable with a t-shirt or sweatshirt emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo.
And your favorite beverage will taste even better in an official Glowing Dial mug or stein.
How about a Glowing Dial tote bag so you can carry around your OTR with style and grace?
Or be the first on your block to own Volume 1 of the Glowing Dial Celebrity Interviews on audio CD.
You can surf the internet with class with an official Glowing Dial mouse pad.
And if that weren't enough, we'll be adding more items with new logo designs in the near future.
Remember, every time you purchase an item from our online store, you are helping to support us here at the Glowing Dial.
You know, you don't even have to leave your home and trudge into your overcrowded, noisy mall. You can just sit comfortably in front of your computer and do all your shopping online.
That's right, Steve. All you have to do is to point your browser to glowingdial.com, scroll down a bit, and click on the Glowing Dial online store link just below the cafepress.com logo. Then, through the wonder of internet technology, you will be instantly whisked to our store's main page.
There you'll see all the items we have to offer. You're sure to find something to suit your fancy. And remember, our official Glowing Dial items make great gifts, too.
And the ordering process is simple and safe using CafePress.com's secure server. Most orders are shipped within 2 business days. You can even check on the status of an existing order.
Head on over to the Glowing Dial online store, the only place you can get official Glowing Dial merchandise. So what are you waiting for?
And we are back. I'm Big John. That's Steve.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome, sir.
They only know my existence because you mentioned me.
That's right. And we have one more show featuring the immortal Jack Webb here. And it's kind of a detective. It's not an official detective show, but it's called Pete Kelly's Blues. And it was also turned into a film by the same name and also a TV show for a little while there. The title of this episode is Gus Trudeau. And it was from August 15th, 1951, originally over NBC. And starring Jack Webb, Bill Conrad, and George Fenneman is announcing, and the show was sustained.
See, there's his favorite again. He likes Bill Conrad. He likes George Fenneman. See, he uses him again.
Mm-hmm. Well, Fenneman was announcer for Dragnet, too.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know. And also Groucho's sidekick on You Bet Your Life. So that Stephen has got the book open here, and he's going to tell us a little bit about Pete Kelly's Blues.
Pete Kelly's Blues, a crime drama. It ran a short time from July to September of 1951 on NBC. And Pete Kelly's Blues arrived on radio almost 2 years after Jack Webb reached stardom in Dragnet. It was a role quite different from the Sergeant Friday stoic character. The world of Pete Kelly was a smoke-filled Kansas City gin mill of the mid-20s, where it's still tough to get a clear gin, but a lady likes the idea of a drink to match the color of her dress. Pete played cornet and headed up a hot jazz combo at George Lupo's at 417 Cherry Street. We start every night about 10 and play till the customers get that first frightening look at each other in the early light. This was a step backward for Webb, back to the tempo and pitch of his hard-boiled pre-Dragnet shows, Pat Novak and Johnny Madero. Never again would he be quite as sassy as in Novak, but as Pete Kelly, he made the 20s roar a little louder and produced another top-notch series whose only drawback was that it ran a mere 12 weeks. All the Webb trademarks were here. The quips, the snappy comebacks, the short-tempered realism. Let's all play together, he would bark as his Big 7 jazz combo opened on a clinker. His world was filled with sidemen, flappers, and gangsters, with prohibition agents lurking around the fringes. Kelly's boss was a fat, friendly little guy who wouldn't harm a fly. There's no money in harming flies. The stories were thin, but the atmosphere is rich. Most of the shows worked the same theme. Kelly would run afoul of some hood or mob boss, and his main work over the half hour was in trying to get out of a bad situation with his skin intact.
All right, there you go. And I wanted to add one other thing here. The music for this series was good enough. Sometimes they featured a full number or two in each episode. The music was by Pete Kelly's Big 7, which in actuality was led by Dick Cathcart on cornet. Others in the band were Matty Matlock on clarinet, Mo Schneider on trombone, Ray Schneider on piano, Marty Korb on the bass, Bill Newman on the guitar, and Nick Fatul on the drums. I just wanted to give those guys credit because the music was popular that they actually released an album with that on it, Pete Kelly's Blues music. So,
30 musicians were auditioned for Pete Kelly's musical voice.
Oh.
Webb chose Dick Cathcart, a cornet player he had known in the Army. That's not why he got the job, he hastened to inform Radiolite. But Webb was known for loyalty to old friends. He had known blues singer Meredith Howard, who played Maggie Jackson since his days at Belmont High, and announcer George Fenneman worked with Webb for years after showing him around when he first broke into radio at KGO. This was one of Webb's best shows and the basis of his 1955 film of the same name.
That's right, as I mentioned. So there we go. All right, the even more information from Steve there. And okay, so once I filled in with the band, you wanted to fill in and add some more there.
I happened to catch that.
Yeah, that's understandable. Like, oh, okay. And that's very good. And so there you have it, folks. That's Pete Kelly's Blues. And it's about time for us to tune that episode in for you here. And then we'll talk a little bit more about Jack. And I have a
this machine is plug loving, one of my... You know, this machine loves me as much as, like, that plant from Little Shop of Horrors. I'm in trouble.
Feed me. Anyway, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember Pete Kelly's Blues. This is Gus Trudeau. From August 15th, 1951, originally over NBC.
This one's about Pete Kelly. About the world he goes around in. It's about the big music and the big trouble in the big 20s. When they ask you, tell them this one's about the blues. Pete Kelly's Blues. Pete Kelly's Blues, starring Jack Webb, with story by Jim Moser, music by Dick Cathcart.
Number 417 Sherry Street is a standard speakeasy. The help is paid in cash, the books are burned at the end of the month. Every week we use 30 cases of booze and a pound of coffee. After salaries, there's gas and lights and a payoff to the Prohibition boys. In Kansas City, the price is good. For $100, they steer in the drunks and make one raid a year. The place is run by George Lupo. He's a quiet little guy who wouldn't give you the sweat off an ice pitcher. The beer's green and the gin's as young as yesterday and the music's loud. I'm Pete Kelly. I play cornet. We start every night about 10 o'clock and we play till they sweep out the broken glass. We don't draw any customers. We don't chase any away. The music is straight New Orleans. It started in the front parlors of Storyville and drifted up north. Some of it laid over in Chicago. That's where I got on. And wrote it out here with a piano player named Augie. Well, he's still with the band, but last night he was barely with it. We took a break about 11. Augie was late getting back. Might as well have stayed in there because he kept looking around the room, and the way the piano sounded, you'd think he had on the catcher's mitt.
All right, that'll do it. Let's get off for a while, huh?
Sorry, Pete. Running a little behind tonight.
You haven't left the station. What's the matter, Augie?
I'm nervous. Take a look around. Near the door, back this way. Place is full of cops.
Well, forget it. Have Jake open a couple of windows. Take a walk. Get yourself in shape, huh?
Not till I find out which way to fall. These boys are here for heavy duty. I learned that out in the kitchen.
Now, let's duck behind the stand. All right, what about it?
You know Dutch Courtney?
I drink his beer, that's all.
Well, somebody shut Courtney up tonight out near Highway 40.
Well, that's too bad. He'd have drawn a good crowd downtown. Who killed him?
I don't know, but whoever he is in for a big night. The police are trying for him. So's his partner.
Well, let him play. How does our place fit into it?
I couldn't guess, but we'll find out soon. See the big guy that just walked in the door?
Yeah, boss cop?
Almost. It's Eddie Newman, Dutch Courtney's partner.
Come on, we better get back in the stand.
Kelly.
Yeah?
My name's Newman.
Come outside.
Well, we're due to play.
I'll hear you later. Come on. You hear about Dutch, Courtney? Picked him out of the mud tonight.
Means nothing to me.
Does to me. Dutch was a friend.
Well, if it'll help, try.
I'm short on time, Kelly. Now, give me a rundown on Gus Trudeau.
There's nothing to say. He played for a while and he went to the boneyard.
You know him. You know his sister.
You'll have to ask Courtney about that. I haven't seen her since the old days.
You knew Gus well enough to figure he didn't like Dutch Courtney. He didn't like him 1 pound.
Well, you can't blame him. Dutch sidestepped and paid Trudeau's way to jail.
Bookkeeping. I don't know anything about it.
All right, look, Newman. You're on the wrong track. This is a job killing. Your boy got frisky and somebody sent down a Chicago gun. The price tag shows.
Sorry, Trudeau's my pick.
What'd he hit him with? A high-powered rifle? Gus Trudeau's away up in Leavenworth.
He used to be. Gus went over the wall this morning. When he shows up, I want him.
Well, why pick me?
I've asked around. He'll head for you. He's broke. He'll need train fare.
No, not if he killed Dutch Courtney. Somebody will give him a railroad.
When they dragged the blues out of the back room and moved them up front, there were three of the best leading the parade. They were all blowing cornets. One was Buddy Bolden, one was King Oliver, and the other was Gus Trudeau. Oh, he was a lot of music, but not much man. He picked me up on a union date on the south side of Chicago and taught me how to play. He got into me for a Boston three-star cornet and gin for the rest of his life. When he got down to running errands for Dutch Courtney, I left for Kansas City. A couple of months later, Courtney needed a patsy, and Trudeau was it. He wound up with a 5-year stand at Leavenworth. But Gus never felt right unless he was in trouble. Only this time, he cut me in for a piece, too. Well, I picked up a drink at the bar and fought my way back to the stand.
Anything wrong?
No. Did you finish the set?
One more to go, Jasmine.
All right, let's do it.
What's wrong, Pete?
A friend of ours killed Dutch Courtney. Jasmine. Get off for a while.
Now, who did you say killed Dutch Courtney?
Gus Trudeau.
What with? Brad? Trudeau's in jail.
No, not since this morning.
Which one of you is Kelly?
I am.
A friend of yours in town wants to see you right away.
Who is it?
He's waiting up at your room.
Did he give a name?
Just Gus.
An hour later, I was still looking for an out. It was a little after 2 a.m. Our base man, Red, loaned me his car keys, and I slipped out. I got onto 12th Street and picked up his Erskine coupe and headed up for my room. All the way out Grand Avenue, the streetlights were spending the rest of New Year's alone. Some guys with wide brooms were pushing at the confetti, and the fog was loafing down in Washington Square. When I got to my place, I parked the car in back and headed up the stairs.
college kids down at the end of the hall had their door open. Their party sounded young. I was looking for Gus when I opened the door, but he had a substitute. I knew her away back at 18th and Halstead. She was pretty and the fastest freight in town. That must have been a long time ago, because somewhere along the line she'd run into a batch of Wednesday weekends. She wasn't pretty anymore.
Hello, Pete.
Where's your brother?
I don't know where Gus is. That's why I'm here. I knew you'd be the first one he'd come to.
Yeah. Now, what about the break?
I was up to see him 2 weeks ago. He didn't say anything about it. Pete, we've got to help him.
I've been hearing that since I met him.
You're the only one who remembers, Pete. You're the only one who cares.
Yeah, well, a lot of people care now. Eddie Newman wants him. The cops are looking hard.
I've got to find him before they do. You've got to help Pete.
He was supposed to meet me. That's all I know. I'll wait for him.
He needs a hand, Pete. He's in deep.
Yeah, well, he's always in deep. Now, you do what you want, Madge. I ran front for Gus too long. I'm out of the habit now.
Please.
Gus wants cover. He can look for a police station.
Gus can get away. Some money and a car. That's all he needs.
It's going to take more than that to get out. Every cop in town's working tonight.
Oh, give him a chance, Pete. Help him.
No, thanks.
Gus has been good to you, Pete. He taught you music. He's been nothing but good to you.
I'm paid up. I bought his gin for 5 years.
Then do it for me. For what I used to be worth.
No, it's old. It was 80 years ago. I can't help Gus.
Do it for me. I haven't changed that much.
I have.
You're still the same.
You've been working at it.
You remember.
Yeah.
It's the same, Petey. It's just like the first time.
You never had a first time. How about a drink?
Will you help me, Pete? Find Gus. Get him out of town.
All right, $10. As far as I go, $10.25. Now I'm getting off.
Where are you going?
Back to work. Tell Gus to take care of himself.
Hold it right there, Pete.
You stay too long in Chicago, Madge.
I bought the gun in Kansas City. Don't go for the door.
You better give it to Gus. He may need it.
We're going to find him. You're going to help me.
All right, come on. Give me the gun, Madge.
If I shoot, it'll hurt.
Come on, put it away, Madge.
Oh,
drop it.
Who is she?
We'll trade. Who are you?
Cage. I work downtown on homicide. Who you got on your floor?
Madge Trudeau.
Tell me about her.
I knew her in Chicago. After that, I heard she did favors for Dutch Corton. After that, I don't know.
Is she tired? What's she doing here?
Looking for Gus Trudeau.
Where is Gus?
I don't know. I've been asked that twice tonight. This is the third time I don't know.
You probably will.
Why? Why do I have to get into this?
Because you're Gus Trudeau's friend.
Then let's get him another one. I'm tired of the job.
I don't blame you, fella. You'll come out of this with a lot of trouble.
For instance?
I'll make it simple. If Gus Trudeau shows and you turn him over to Newman, we'll send you up as an accessory to murder.
Yeah.
If he shows and you turn him over to us, Newman will probably kill you.
Oh, that's real good. In the meantime, what do you guys do for a living?
We're busy. We couldn't prove Newman killed you. It's after 2. Get back to that club.
And leave you here?
I got work to do.
Like what?
This woman. I'll see if I can get anything out of her.
Yeah, well, it's been done before, but I'll bet 10-1 in your case.
Go on, Vac. I'll tidy up here.
Good night, cop. Leave the rugs. I left Cade standing in the middle of the room looking down at Madge Trudeau. He didn't watch me leave, but I figured it wouldn't be too long before he turned that gleam back on me. Well, I went back to 417 and ran into our piano man, Augie, outside in the alley trying to steal some clean air.
Happy holidays, Petey. How's Gus?
I didn't see him.
Oh, forget him. I got it all figured out for the two of us, Petey. Today we'll spend our time dodging destiny. We'll hit for some small back room. I'll bring the bottle goods, and we'll live on gin and sauerkraut and make the waltz sit up and listen. One horn, one piano. The blues, Petey. We'll write them in the middle of next year.
All right, save it, will you? Just set me straight.
Right now, across the river, there's two places. The High Life Club or Fat Annie's.
You sure he's there?
That's what the word is. I'll pass the hat down at the Union Hall for both of you.
Is Gus alone over there?
He is now, but there's going to be a crowd.
What do you mean?
I told you.
Yeah.
When Eddie Newman gets back, I gotta tell him.
I knew it was a silly move. Newman had 100 guns on tour for Gus. Cage and the boys from headquarters were standing by for seconds. Helping Gus Trudeau was out of order, but I couldn't get one thing out of my mind. If Gus did kill Courtney, why didn't he pick up some travel money before he did it? I was backward. If you're going to hang up your pants, you take them off first. Well, it was about 3 a.m. when I got down to the river and crossed over to the Kansas side. The High Life Club was smoked up and had a little of everything, except Gus Trudeau. I looked in the kitchen and tried a back room, then I went to the bar to see if I could drum up some talk. I had one taker, a boy with wavy black hair. He got up from a table of three others, walked over and sat down next to me.
Hello. Come in your office?
No, it's the first time.
Welcome, then. Buy a drink?
No, I'm all set. Try one yourself.
Oh, I think drinking's all right, but I hate people who drink too much, don't you?
You work here?
Well, not regularly. Sometimes I dance and the other act doesn't show up. I'm here alone, waiting for someone.
Waiting for a guy named Gus Trudeau.
You one of his friends?
I'm it. Where is he?
He left a while ago. I'm not sure where he
went.
Well,
get sure. It's important.
When I mentioned someone named Bessie,
all right, hold it.
What are you here, Kelly?
All right, get away, Newman. Try another stool.
This'll do.
If he asked you to leave, I think you should leave.
Well, well. Choir boy. That's nice.
Leave him alone.
Who is he?
I never saw him before.
What's he know about Trudeau?
Nothing.
Don't kid me. You're not here to spend the time of day. You're here for Trudeau. You, little friend, where's Gus Trudeau?
I don't have to talk to you. I'm a guest in this place.
You're not anymore. Now climb down and head for that door, both of you.
Can't make us do that. We're not going to leave.
It's a split vote, Buster. I don't like the way he pushes.
That's right. Just walk. I'll bet you look good.
I knew right then. As we walked out, I knew Eddie Newman wasn't going to leave him alone. He was going to pick at him. Whether he knew anything about Gus Trudeau or not, it was going to get messy. And the boy with the nice eyes was going to help. Outside, it wasn't snowing anymore, but the ground was covered right down to the river. The moon out, and it looked all right, if you like nature. We walked over toward a bunch of trees. Newman's car was parked there, a black touring sedan with a strong-arm guy in the back seat. There was another one sitting on the running board. He had a machine gun across his lap.
This'll do. All right. Now let's hear about Gus Trudeau.
I don't know anything about him. This man and I were just talking.
Go easy, Newman. I never saw him before.
Does he always talk to strangers? I'll bet he does.
None of your business.
Where's Gus Trudeau?
I wouldn't tell you. Suppose I knew, I wouldn't tell you.
Oh, yes, you would.
Keep your hands off of me.
Stop pressing, Newman. You don't care about Trudeau now. You just don't like this guy.
Stay out, Kelly. Come here, you. Stop screeching. I'll break your arm off.
Keep your hands off of me, you big, you dirty pig.
You're in trouble, fella. Shut up.
He is a pig. His hands are dirty and his teeth are dirty. I'll even his clothes are dirty. All of them.
Now lay there. All right, Dave, move in here. Back away, Kelly. You're up, choir boy.
Please, mister, do something. Don't let a thing like this happen.
It already has, Buster.
You all through, Newman?
Come on, Dave. It's getting cold.
Newman climbed into the car and they drove off. I stayed there a minute to look at the guy in the snow. His face was unmarked. I did him a favor. I rolled him over so it showed in the moonlight. I knew his mother'd want him to look good the night Eddie Newman's chopper squad cut him down. Well, the name Bessie had to mean Fat Annie's place up the river on the Kansas side. I made it there and found Bessie. She was back at the piano wandering around somewhere in the middle of the blues. You couldn't miss that voice if she took up yodeling. Bessie Smith.
Hi, Pete.
Hi, Bessie. What do you know?
Round back, Pete. You go up the stairs, the loft. Way up there at the top.
Thanks, Bessie.
Okay, Pete. All right, Eddie.
I felt my way out around back and up a couple of flights of stairs that didn't creak in time with the music. There was a door at the top. I pushed it open. He was hunched back on a pile of hay in the corner. He sat up and blinked a couple of times. There wasn't much left, just the frame. And rattling around inside, a lot of tired echoes that wouldn't lay down and die. There was an empty gin bottle on the floor.
Petey, I knew you'd get here.
Yeah, well, they didn't make it easy.
You're looking good, Petey. Everything's 6-2 and even, huh?
You forget easy, Gus. You're in a jam. You broke jail.
Yeah, I told him all about you up there, Petey. I told him there's another Gus Trudeau blowing down in Kansas City. I'm proud of you, Petey.
Yeah, sure, Gus.
You're just like me, Pete. I told him all about you. You're the only good thing I ever done. I knew you'd come through. Car and some money, Pete. It'll do everything. It'll make it all new. Is it too much to ask? You tell me, Pete.
They want you for Dutch Courtney.
You know better, Pete. I didn't kill Dutch.
Well, you had a reason.
Did I? I forget.
He hung a frame on you, Gus. 5 years' worth, remember?
I didn't kill Dutch. Give me a drink, a boy.
No, not tonight.
Don't preach at me. Just something to help me on.
Oh, yeah, now come in out of the fog, Gus. You're going to get a drink or a train ticket for me. Take your pick, because it's the last time around.
Just listen to that. Bessie's still going strong, ain't she?
Yeah, and so are the cops. I got one idea for you, Gus. Get moving.
You remember Chicago, Petey? You and Madge? Chicago always liked me.
You checked out, Gus. Beiderbecke's got your cheer.
They'll remember me and you, Petey. I found you when you were nothing.
What are you going to do? Where are you going?
I got it all set up. It's big and brand new. A place in Mexico.
Yeah?
The guy who bunked in my cell with me, his mother runs a place down there. It'll be just like it used to be.
You won't get there on a gin bottle.
I got it set up, boy. A car and some money. It's not much to ask. You haven't got a drink, have you?
You can drink in Mexico. Where are you dreaming up the car and the dough?
It's fixed, boy. You just see this guy and tell him I'm ready. Abe Gaffney. He's got a place on Pershing Road. You know it?
Yeah, I know it. Abe's doing all this?
Just tell him I'm ready. How's Madge?
She's all right.
Come and see me, huh? It's hot down in Mexico.
Gets hot here.
What's the matter, Pete? You ain't sore, are you?
No, I ain't sore. I'm just tired. I'll tell Gaffney and then I'm checking out. Goodbye, Gus.
You're not getting too big for your old friends, are you, boy?
Friends are like everything else, Gus.
Yeah?
They wear out on you. Wasn't any different than a dozen times before. I knew there wasn't very much left, but I wasn't looking for a second-rate ghost with an empty gin bottle. Well, I crossed the river to the Missouri side, headed down Main Street, and then I swung over toward Abe Gaffney's place on Pershing Road. It was pushing close to 5:30 a.m. Sun wasn't up yet, and the night was too tired to care. I pulled up in front of the Murad sign out in front of Gaffney's. Inside, a counterman with pimples and coffee was leaning on last night's paper. A beaded curtain shut off the hallway that led back to Gaffney's room.
You want something?
Yeah, Gaffney.
Not here.
Where do I find him?
I don't know.
I was supposed to meet him here.
That's so?
Look, this is Gaffney's place. Where is he?
I told you.
Now, listen, Junior. Maybe you think you do a good imitation of Calvin Coolidge, but I want an answer. Where's Gaffney?
What's your name?
Kelly.
You could have saved an argument this way. Throw the curtain.
When do you go to bed, Kelly?
Yeah. You still looking, Newman?
I'm still asking. Where's Guts?
I don't think he'd give me time to answer.
There's a good reason why I let you walk away tonight. I gave you 2 hours all by yourself on the Kansas side. I don't think you threw him away. You got a line on Gus Trudeau, and I want it.
I got nothing for you.
Don't be silly, Pete. The cops get him or I do. He goes either way.
You get no help from me.
I don't want help. I want Gus. Now, come on! Come on! Come on, or I'll make you part of the wallpaper.
You better send for Dave.
I don't need it.
I think you do. Now, don't bother to get up. I'm leaving.
I don't believe it. Wasn't your turn, Kelly.
When I got up off the floor, the room was cold and the lights were out. Newman was gone, but I knew he was still in business. I knew if he didn't find Gus Trudeau this trip, he'd come back for me. Well, I got into Red's car and followed the radiator cap back to 417. I found Alton back at the stand having breakfast.
Could you bring an egg, Petey? Kitchen's closed down.
Newman been back here?
I haven't noticed. You look abused.
Yeah. Did anybody say anything?
Who missed? You heard the news?
What's that?
They found the guy who got Dutch Courtney. Fellow by the name of Doyle. East St. Louis. Cops got the goods on him. Gun, fingerprints, the works.
What was his beef with Dutch?
Doyle owned East St. Louis. Dutch wouldn't believe it.
I'll leave it to Gus. If there's a hole, he'll fall in it.
Makes it easier, doesn't it? Newman will call his boys off now.
Somebody better tell him in a hurry.
Did you see Gus?
Yeah, I saw him. He's trying to get out of town.
Pete Kelly?
That's right.
Dave Gaffney, Pete.
Well, you're a hard man to find.
Newman came in the front door. I went out the back. This won't take long. Car keys and money for Gus.
Oh, you got the wrong guy, Abe. I quit an hour ago.
Fight it out with yourself. The car's out in the alley. Gray Chandler. Tell Gus it's low on gas.
No, wait a minute. You can take this stuff to Gus. You know where he is.
No, thanks. You take care of Gus. He's an old friend.
What's the matter with you?
I hardly know him.
The clock over the bar said 6:15. We got back on the stand and started the last set. 80 pounds of stale cigarette smoke was holding up the ceiling, waving down in a dirty blue curtain over the dance floor. Behind the bar, one of the guys was wiping up. Two couples picked their way to the dance floor, pushed each other around a while, and finally gave up. Oh, the whole thing, it was all out of step. Wrinkled stockings, brown gardenias, torn paper hats, and Gus Trudeau. He walked in the door and stood off to one side, just back of the stand.
Hey, Pete, Gus got here. He's late now.
Don't make book on it. All right, last one. The blues in B-flat. Same call tonight, 10 o'clock. You can talk.
Pete. Petey. Over here.
I heard you. You sound good, Pete. Just what I told him up there. You're on your way, boy.
All right. Now, you heard it, Gus. Here's the money. And the car keys. I'll see you, Gus.
You know what I told him? Another Gus Trudeau's blown down in Kansas City.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, boy. I'm leaving.
Happy New Year, Gus.
Hi, Madge.
Hold it there, Pete. It's a family fight. Stay out.
I thought I took that gun away from you.
What's the matter, Madge? What are you doing?
Don't tell me that talk, Gus. Dutch can't hear you.
What do you mean, Madge?
You killed him. You blew your top and killed him just like you did everything else for me. You and that gin and that cheap brass horn of yours. You sped us all, Pete and me. You ran through the whole bunch till you got to Dutch.
Gee, I didn't do anything.
You killed Dutch Courtney. I loved him. I loved him enough to square him.
You got it wrong, Madge.
Goodbye, Gus. I'll tell him to throw your horn in after you.
Read the paper, Madge. You killed the wrong brother.
Stay away, Pete.
It's in the paper, Madge. A guy by the name of Doyle. He killed Dutch.
They're not sure. Are they?
They're sure.
What'll I do?
I got two things for you, Madge. And the car keys. Now, you see what you can do with 10 minutes start.
You didn't have anything more for Gus, did you, Pete?
No, I guess not.
Well, you made it.
Yeah, Gus finally got out of town.
Valley's Blues, starring Jack Webb, with story by Jim Moser, music by Dick Cathcart, scoring by Matty Matlock. Pete Kelly's Blues is based on characters created by Richard L. Breen. NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Hi, folks. This is actress Beverly Washburn. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Pete Kelly's Blues. That was Gus Trudeau, and that was from August 15th, 1951, originally over NBC. And that's just about going to wrap it up for us here on The Glowing Dial for this edition, this tribute to Jack Webb. Hope you've enjoyed it, folks. We want to do something we neglected to do at the top of the show, and is wish you a happy Independence Day. Right, yes, because 2 days into the run of this episode, we celebrate the 4th of July, so you'll all be having... stuffing yourself with barbecue and going to fireworks shows. Ooh, ah. I know we, and me and a couple of buddies, we try to take in as many as we can around the area. And I think our record is up to like 6 in one season. But, you know, if we were really crazy and if gas weren't so damned expensive, we'd be...
My suggestion, Johnny, you want to see more, you should go and watch as many Honeymooner episodes as you can. There's like fireworks on there, you know.
I always think of that when I'm at a show and nobody else gets it when I do The Honeymooners or Jackie Gleason, The Honeymooners with the stars Art Carney, Audrey Meadows, and Joyce Randolph. Everybody looks at me like I'm an idiot or something, and I'm the only one aside from you that obviously remembers that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, anyway, I alluded to telling a little bit more about Jack Webb. Of course, we mentioned that aside from all this radio work, he did a lot of TV work as well. His company, Mark 7 Limited, did shows like Adam 12. Other than Dragnet, he did Adam 12.
Yep, I remember that one.
He did Emergency.
Oh, yes. That was very popular.
He did, there were a couple others, but I do remember Project UFO being one of them. And it was one that's one that's near and dear to my heart, and I'm going to give a bit of a plug right now. If you have, thank you, Stephen. If you visited my webpage, the Glowing Dial page, you'll see... if you scroll down a little ways, there's banners for my other websites. And the Project UFO page is there. And I did that page for the show because there was no other Project UFO page on the internet at the time I did this. And there is one over in Italy, but basically he just copied me. And I showed you this before, I think, Steve. The guy actually just... there was a version of my webpage at that time, and he virtually just carbon copied it and... use the same layout and everything, and didn't even write to me and say, hey, can I do this? Mm-hmm. Unfortunately. But, what are you going to do? I guess since imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, isn't it? Since yes. I'm not making a dime off it, he's doing it in Italian, I'm doing it in English, whatever. But, so take a look over there, folks. It's all about Project UFO, and there's a whole lot of Jack Webb's radio work that can be listened to over there as well. So, check all of that out, and I guess that's my plug. I'm not going to go into heavy detail about it or anything, but that's that. And I think Paul Whiteman and the boys are waiting in the backdrop there to start playing our song. Are you going to hit it there, boys? Yes, you are. All right. Yes, the ghost of Paul Whiteman and his orchestra is in the other corner by the door there, so we can't get the door open because the band's in the way. You know, the audience is, well, they've gone home.
We got Ringo, we got the my fans,
if,
we've got...
If the audience has gone home, why don't we stick the band in the closet where the audience was so we can get in and out of the door if we need to, you know? Okay, thank you, Ringo. He's going to take care of that. Good. Anyway, those reminders, folks, before we actually say goodbye here, don't forget that Chicken Man set. Every time you purchase one of those, it helps to support us here at the Glowing Dial. I know it's a little on the expensive side, but just take a look at all you're getting for your money there.
Well,
don't forget to visit glowingdial.com. That's our website. Everything that has to do with this show and things nostalgic. We will also find the celebrity birthday list there on our site. Don't forget our other three most favoritest websites. Well, actually, it's four. I keep saying three, but it's four. It's Yesterday USA, Stay Tuned America, Jerry Handiga's Vintage Radio Place, and his old-time radio network. And also, don't forget those contact methods, folks. We want to hear from you, whether it's requests you have or ideas for a theme for a future show. Whatever it is, we'd like to hear from you. And don't forget those donation methods, folks. Any or all of those help to support us here at the Glowing Dial. And believe me, we could use all the help we can get. And one of those is the Glowing Dial online store. Now with several new items we've added recently, including that wonderful new Glowing Dial clock, wall clock, that has a nice big radio dial on it. So check that and all the other stuff out. And that's it for the reminders. So you know what's left, Stephen.
We have to say our line.
Until we're with you next time, folks, we want to say keep a positive thought.
Keep looking up.
Think big.
And we'll see you on the radio.
Bye-bye until then.